Good morning, and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I remind everyone present to turn off electrical devices that may interfere with the sound systems or turn to silent otherwise. I have apologies from Gil Patterson, and we have a question for the committee, which is whether or not item 3 can be taken in private. Are we all agreed on that? Thank you. Now, we have four witnesses with us today for our gender pay gap inquiry, and I'll introduce them from my left to right. First of all, we have Rosie MacRae, who is the Head of Inclusion and Diversity at SSE. Welcome. Then we have Shirley Campbell, who's the Director for People from Scottish Water. Again, welcome. And Megan Horsburgh, who is the Head of Diversity and Inclusion for Sodexo UK and Ireland. Good morning. And finally, Katriona, who is the HR Director for Diageo Global Supply. Welcome to you as well. So we'll start off this morning with a question from committee member Bill Bowman.
Thank you, convener. A nice straightforward question, which may be harder to answer. Are you confident that there are definitive sets of statistics within Scotland on pay, earnings and employment for women? And if not, what would you suggest?
Who would like to take that question? If you want to come in on any question I should have said, please just indicate by raising your hand and I'll bring you in. The sound desk will deal with the microphone, so you don't need to push any buttons. Who would like to start? Shirley Campbell.
Thank you very much. I don't know if you'd say it's distinctive, because I'm perhaps a little different from others in the panel here, that Scottish Water is obviously a public corporation. So we've been publishing figures on inclusion, diversity, gender, our pay gap since 2013 as part of the public sector equality duty. But behind the scenes and voluntarily, we also look at the sort of normal pay definition, the one that's the UK definition, and we've got our information in that regard as well, although that's not something we publish, because we don't have an accountability to do that, a responsibility to do that. So I guess where it's not distinctive is where you have different organisations using the different methodologies and the different approaches to calculation that may lead to complexities down the line, but certainly it helps us to create statistics using both definitions.
Katriona, Mackie.
Yeah, I mean, I'm aware of some of the statistics that are around. I think it's always good to have more transparency, and I think it's always good to have more information in that regard. And I would hope that, you know, some of the gender pay reporting and things that will be done will give us a different lens, I think, on that, so that we're a bit clearer.
Thank you. Rosie MacRae.
Also, to add to that, some stats that would be good that would help influence the gender pay gap are things like the amount of roles that are advertised offering flexible working or part-time working. I know there's some stats about that across the UK which says something like 8% of roles that are advertised over £20,000 offer some sort of flexible working. Those kind of stats are really helpful, because it's those types of initiatives, I think, that are going to drive a change in the gender pay gap.
Thank you. I think so. What you're saying is that you have, or some of you have, your own figures that you're using as a measure of how you're progressing or changing, but there's not perhaps a definitive set that you would look to nationally to compare to.
There is a national reliable approach, which is the way the information will be asked to be reported. So we use that. We haven't invented our own. Mm-hmm. But what we're required to publish is the gender pay gap as per the public sector equality duty. And we have been doing that in the same way since 2013. So we've got trend data for that, but we also find it useful to use the more comprehensive calculator, which is the way others on the panel will be calculating their gender pay gap in due course.
Thank you. I just wonder if I might follow up on something Rosie MacRae said about flexible working, because if one is looking purely at the pay in monetary terms, does that obscure the issue for some workers? Some of the public sector organisations that we'll hear from later have commented on the need for flexible working and so forth, but I'm just wondering how that fits with approaching the issue from a monetary point of view, because of course that doesn't necessarily take into account other compensations or other things that employees may feel are important in their job package, indeed both male and female employees. And of course, I'm just wondering how for private companies that can be worked into your approach to things, and whether or not that calls into question approaching things just using a statistical analysis, as it were, by saying this is the gender pay gap in terms of money, but not taking account of other factors. And does that actually cause part or help to feed into part of the problem? Rosie MacRae.
I guess the views on that are what we understand now is there's a penalty applied to those that take time out of the workplace, and also a bias that exists for people who are working flexibly or indeed part-time. And normally that's not affecting the pay gap at the point that it starts. So you come back from maternity, say, and you say, I want to come back and reduce hours. Your salary doesn't change. Your bonus, if you get one, wouldn't change. It would just be aligned to the hours you work. But what happens is the ongoing impact of that and the opportunities for you to progress and those jobs in the progression route being offered on flexible working, people feel trapped within that. So we do understand where people are working flexibly, they feel there's little room for progression because the roles that are being advertised aren't on the same flexible, agile working package. So you do feel trapped in the role that you're in, and that seems to be the issue. So we would like to, and we would encourage more senior roles and senior positions to be advertised looking at agile and flexible working.
Yes, Shirley Campbell.
Thank you. I mean, I think it's a really interesting point. There's some evidence to suggest that if you offer agile working or flexible working, it's worth, on average, to a person 5% on basic pay. So a job externally would have to be offering a new salary, either 5% or higher, to encourage that person to move company once they've experienced the benefits of flexible working and agile working. And we've been pursuing agile working as agenda pan-Scottish water for about 2 or 3 years now, and we've got some quite interesting statistics in terms of the effect of that. So when we do advertise now, there's a presumption that it will be done on a fluid basis that doesn't have a location-specific element to it. And interestingly, I was looking at some statistics yesterday. Our numbers of part-time men have doubled since 2013. So it is having an impact, but I think definitely your question, is it worth something? We have a rule of thumb that it's worth about 5% increases on base pay.
Do you have figures on that you could share with the committee?
Yes.
In writing after today's meeting? Sorry, did others want to come in on that point? Megan Horsburgh.
Yeah, very happy to. So, I mean, from a Sodexo perspective, flexibility is something that we've recognised as one of the key elements that help us to achieve gender balance within our workforce, and I'd absolutely echo the points made by the other committee members. I think, you know, we know that flexibility is not only good for working women, we also know that it's good for men as well, and so in that regard, it fits incredibly well with our overall approach to gender balance, which is actually a number of these initiatives benefit the whole organisation and all employees and not just women.
Mm-hmm. I think maybe just to build on some of the comments that have already been made, I think what we're really trying to do at Diageo is understand, you know, what will it take to make things more possible for people? In our Scottish business here, we have a lot of manufacturing and operational people. And so we know that in our office roles and in some of our functions, flexible working can be easier to actually offer to people than elsewhere. So what we're really trying to do is kind of work out what is it that people really value to enable them to stay in the workplace and progress as they want to and release their full potential. And I think, you know, you were saying, is it just about pay and is that the one wrong thing to look at? I think it really is to look at statistics across the kind of entire talent life cycle, if you want, that you look at. So one of the things that we're almost moving away from is just looking at how many women have we got or how many men have we got, and trying to work out how many women do we attract at, you know, recruitment stage, what's happening in our promotions, you know, are we seeing balance there? What's happening, are more people leaving the organisation, you know, male or women, so that you're kind of getting a much more holistic view of what it's really going to take to have a gender-balanced organisation in the future.
Thank you. And now a question from Jackie Bailey.
I think Katriona Mackie touched on this earlier, and that's the forthcoming pay gap reporting legislation. I wonder if the panel think it will make any difference in reducing the gap.
I'm happy to start with that question. From a Sodexo perspective, we absolutely believe that it will make a difference. We think that anything that brings gender balance into the public eye is a real positive. But I think our experience is that we published our first number back in November. And I think one of our concerns is around people understanding the true difference between equal pay and the gender pay gap. And that's something certainly that as we've presented that information out into the public and indeed with our own employees, and we employ about 35,000 people across the UK and Ireland, 3,000 of which are in Scotland, we've come to realise that there's still a great deal of education that needs to be done to help people to understand the difference between those concepts. So I think for us, whilst the number tells a certain story, it's really the narrative which is going to be critical to change being made in a positive manner.
We agree in SSE. We agree with that, and one thing we'd welcome would be a broadening, actually, of the regulation to say the narrative is as important as the figure. We reported last year in line with the guidelines, and so that was 2 years ahead. We were proud of that, but we were most proud of the narrative that we provided with it, because there were few companies to look at and look at their pay gap and what was said, and sometimes we found the number kind of hidden away in a bunch of stats. It really is only helpful when people talk about what they're doing to address it. And that allows them year on year to say, has that achieved something? What can we learn from it? So we're really welcoming that for what we'll see next year as part of the gender pay gap reporting and what we can learn from others that's making a difference.
I think there is evidence that it does create a good focus, because when we started reporting our gender pay gap in 2013, we had a very, very small gap in favour of women. And in 2017, our April report that's yet to be published will show a slightly bigger gender pay gap in favour of women. So I think there's evidence to suggest that when you do publish and you do look at it and you have that transparency, it does have an effect.
Guidelines apply to those companies with over 250 employees. When you're talking about broadening it in respect of the narrative, do you think there is an argument to broaden it to include more companies, given that Scotland's economy is driven by SMEs principally?
I think yes would be the answer to that. However, very small movement can create big percentage shifts if it's a very small company. So there might be a lot that might look positive or negative for an organisation, and it's really just because of very marginal changes. So that would be the complexity with very small organisations, I suggest.
I think we also think it's a really positive thing to do. I think it's like anything that you do. If you understand the data and you understand, you know, what's actually going on in your organisation, then it gives you other places to probe and go looking to understand the root causes about, you know, why is this the case? So, you know, I think kind of reporting and data can really help liberate some of that. I think this will bring a different lens to the way that we've looked at things in the past. So I would be really confident that it would drive change.
Agreed. And we learnt an awful lot, you know, because agreeing last year to report our gender pay gap, we obviously did a lot of counting, and then we did a lot of learning from what the stats were telling us. And we are now pretty confident as to where we need to put our efforts. You know, we've got 6,200 employees in the top 10 operational roles, and out of those, 200 are held by women. You know, and it's in these operational roles where the skill level is higher than those that many of the women are choosing to enter into retail and administration. But not only that, the progression points are different as well. In the operational roles, there are 5 points of progression, so your career can be longer and there's more opportunity to progress. And oftentimes in the retail and the admin functions, it's 3 points of progression. So we've learned a lot from that. And we already knew, kind of, that we didn't have many women in these roles. But to learn that science behind it and the progression points really helped us put a spotlight on it and say, OK, what are we doing to attract more women into those roles?
And I think, you know, for Sodexo, it's not just only looking at our own employees, so those within our organisation currently, it's also thinking what we can do to inspire the next generation. So this is an area where I believe that employers and large organisations have a duty to actually get the people within their organisations who perhaps do roles which don't fit with typical gender stereotypes to actually be going into schools and inspiring future generations, because we know sometimes that the aspirations of boys and girls differ from a very early age, and I think that's an opportunity that large organisations have got to contribute to this issue on a wider societal basis.
May I ask, just following on from that, first of all, do you do breakdown of statistics for Scotland in terms of your reporting, or is it UK-wide? Or
from a Sodexo perspective, we the stats that we've released and the stats that we will release will be UK-wide, and that's because we're headquartered in London, so actually creating some stats specifically for Scotland may be a bit misleading.
Well, I'm just wondering whether they'd be misleading or whether they might be useful from a Scottish perspective if there were a possibility to do that. I mean, it may not be required by the legislation, but is it something you might think of looking at?
Yeah, certainly happy to take that away and look into it.
And a further question, I think already Shirley Campbell has indicated, I think your reporting, you said, indicated a gender pay gap in favour of women in your organisation, but to your organisation and the others, is it possible to share your own gender pay gap information to a greater level of detail than perhaps what is published? Is that something you'd be willing to do for the committee?
Yes, what we're going to do anyway, when we publish our public sector equality duty report, which has to come out in, I think it's due in April this year, we will use the public sector equality duty approach to reporting, but in addition, in the appendix, we'll use the UK normal pay approach and just show what that means. So we're not duty bound to report that, but we're going to include the more forensic information in the report as well.
Thank you. And
yeah, we'd be happy to share. I mean, obviously, we have internal measures as well that aren't regulatory, and that's how we are kind of creating a scorecard. Be happy to share that with you. For us, we've got 21,000 employees across the UK and Ireland, and 7,000 of those are in Scotland. So it's not something we report on just now nationally, but it's something we could look into.
Yeah, I think we would expect to report, you know, for Scotland as well. So our business in the UK, we have probably about 4/5 of it is probably in Scotland with all of our kind of operational areas and things. So it's a hugely significant part of what we do. And I think we will be expecting to publish Diageo Scotland data as well as UK data.
Okay. Well, perhaps the committee can write to your companies and on that point. Now come to a question from Gillian Martin.
Good morning. You've already all touched on some of the measures that you're taking to eradicate the gender pay gap and to encourage women into your industries, but also to progress within. I'd like to give you all the opportunity to tell me a wee bit more in detail about what you're doing to encourage more women into your sectors, particularly in the utilities sector, where, as you've pointed out, that it's been kind of unbalanced up until this point.
I'm happy to start. So our narrative following the gender pay gap report last year was around encouraging more women in, on and up, and that seems to have landed quite well in the organisation. It makes sense. So from a recruitment point and coming in, I guess with our learnings about career choices and the lack of women coming into the technical roles, we made a big investment last year with an education charity called Teach First, who help provide teachers in the most deprived schools across England and Wales. We entered into a partnership with them because we thought social inclusion was incredibly important to SSE. But also offered us an opportunity to look at women into STEM so that we could encourage, this was giving us access to 200,000 school children, so at scale, to talk about career choices and also to encourage more girls to participate in STEM subjects. So that was a real win. I think we've had some good success with some simple things that we've done, and these haven't cost a lot of money. You know, it's things like looking at how we're advertising for our engineering graduates, for example. What's the imagery we're using? What's the language that we're using? And making some tweaks to that, we've seen great changes. I mean, last year, I think our intake of females into the engineering graduate programme was 17%, and this year it's 40%. So we did some really good things going out to the City of Glasgow College, for example, speaking to, with Equate Scotland actually, you know, speaking to the female engineering students. We had Twitter Q&A sessions. We just did things differently in order to show that we were open and inclusive to women as well as men. So that's on the in. I think on the on, we've... So this is making sure our women feel that there are routes to progress. We've done a lot on our career sites internally. So bringing more stories to life, not just of women who are working flexibly and are still achieving great things, but also on men, and many of our men, managers are men, talking about the benefits they get from encouraging agile and flexible working. And that's been a real thing for us. We've got a big building opening up in Reading, which means that some of our satellite offices are closing, and we've got 1,200 employees moving into a Reading hub office. And we've used that as a mass scale pilot for working differently, we're calling it. So it's really encouraging occasional home working. There's been a big investment in technology there. And this is a big change. You know, it's a cultural change for our managers. It's a change for our employees. But doing that at scale allows us to pilot it in a meaningful way, but also to measure that as well and see if it's something we would roll out across the rest of the organisation. Which I think has been very good. And some practical things we've done just to encourage difference overall, because the education piece is really important as well, about what are we doing this all for? It's not just about women, it's the greatness that difference brings and all the creativity and innovation. So we've seen things like the introduction of shadow boards in some of our directorates, where it's not the normal faces around the table dealing with the big business challenges, but we're looking at different people, different backgrounds getting together and taking on some of these business challenges and coming up with different responses, and that's been really welcomed.
The utility, shall I go next? I would echo many of the things Rosie has said in terms of trying to encourage sector attractiveness, but very practically for us at Scottish Water, we've been looking at both ends of the career spectrum to see what we could do to change the mix. So, for example, we have now a very large number of modern apprentices that we bring into Scottish Water every year. Back in 2013, only 11% of those were female. We're now up to just under 20% of the modern apprentices that we bring in are female. So we've done a huge amount to profile female modern apprentices through social media and using the press, and encourage them into what were traditional male roles. The other thing we've launched is we've used some people analytics to determine what are our five roles at Scottish Water who traditionally have only been filled by men, because irrespective of our positive gender pay gap, we still do have lots of occupational segregation. So we've got five roles that we know are more attractive to males, and we now have a referral scheme for males and females to refer young women who might be suitable for those particular roles. We typically only recruit STEM graduates at Scottish Water, and over the last few years we've been delighted that we've more or less had a 50-50 gender mix in our graduate intakes. And we've been running 10-year future leadership programmes, so getting individuals senior leader ready or executive director ready in 10 years. And in cohort one of our internal people that went on that programme, 76% of those were female in the first cohort and 50% were female in the second cohort. So we feel our long-term pipelines are becoming much more gender balanced. We've also, at the more senior level, we've worked with the Scottish Government on the Shadow Boards initiative. We've signed up to the Scottish Business Pledge. We're signed up to 50-50 by 2020. And the outcome of that is that back in 2015, 9.1% of our board were female. In 2017, 27.3%. of our board are female. So again, that's had a real impact. And then at the national level, in the sector overall, we work very closely with Energy and Utility Skills, and they have just published their workforce renewal and skills strategy through to 2020. So we're very active in helping them develop that, and it's very focused on sector attractiveness, so that there isn't a skills shortage through to 2020. We actually feature case studies in that strategy, and the case study is on the ways in which we're encouraging flexible retirement, principally for males in traditional operational roles. And when they flexibly retire, it allows us to bring a modern apprentice into the business to buddy with them until the date of their final retirement. So it allows knowledge transfer, and it allows that case study to be looked at to determine, would it, if this person did flexibly retire, would it allow the opportunity to create a better gender balance in that type of role? So that's part of the actual case study, the business case for a flexible retirement going through. So a number of things I think that have made a difference.
So from a Sodexo perspective, we've had a global commitment to gender balance since 2009, and that's something that's championed by our global CEO, Michel Londel. And as part of that commitment, he set up a global steering committee of some of our most senior men and women to particularly focus their attention on how do we drive gender balance throughout the organisation, so at all management grades and within all occupations. And there are a number of initiatives which have come out of that group, and we've seen some really good progress since 2009. In particular, that group under Michelle's leadership has put in place some aspirational targets around the number of women in our senior management positions, and that's something which we've found is very much focused attention. And those targets look to create a 40% representation of women. And we've got to that 40% because we actually did a large-scale internal piece of research which looked at the gender balance business case. So we absolutely recognise the work that McKinsey and others have done in that space, but we actually wanted to see how that translated into our own organisation. And what we found is that where there was a 40 to 60% balance, those entities were actually 13% more likely to report consistent organic growth, 23% more likely to show an increase in gross profit, and they also performed better on measures like employee engagement, client satisfaction, and client retention. And so that's what's driven our focus on achieving this 40% in those senior management positions. As part of SWIFT, they've got a particular focus on some of the topics that have already been touched on, so things like leadership development, promoting flexible working, encouraging the start-up and continuation of gender balance employee network groups, because we know that through those groups people get access to informal and formal mentoring schemes and access to role models in perhaps non-traditional roles. And we also have a Women Work Employee Network group locally within the UK and Ireland, which again looks to replicate some of those initiatives.
Okay, I'll tell you a bit about what we've been doing. if I think about some of the things my colleagues have spoken about here in terms of attracting people in, then, you know, we've been doing a number of the same things. I think we worked with Skills Development Scotland on the Not Just for Boys campaign, which I think was great, really around, again, showing people that to pursue careers in STEM-type subjects. It's a really great opportunity. I think for a long time now, we have had kind of 50-50 graduate intake coming in. And I think at the moment, we're sitting with about 31% of apprentices would be girls as well. So that, and again, over the last 5 years, that's been quite a progression. But there's still a lot of things to do. Again, then utilising some of the people that are breaking through into some in some new space. So, for example, in Islay, on our we have a number of distilleries on Islay, and in our apprentices, we brought on two males and two females, and we actually used them to kind of really help encourage and front up campaigns to kind of drive this idea that there are some fabulous experiences for women in our industry. And we also, the whole role modelling thing, I think, and opening up people's minds to opportunities is something that we use a lot. So even you probably think about Scotch whisky and you probably think that's quite a kind of male-dominated industry. And in a sense, in terms of some of our operations roles, it is. But, you know, even some of our master blenders and things are women who've worked for 40 years in our industry. So I think a lot of this is about the stories that we tell and actually encouraging people to just see the world of work differently and really think about what's the possibility for me in these things. So there's a lot of work goes on about trying to get new people to come into the business in a gender balanced way. But obviously, we're also very fortunate that we have a loyal workforce. And when people join us, they tend to stay for a long time. So some of the things I think that we've tried to do around gender balance is, again, use this role modelling idea to run internal programmes, which we've called Women in Leadership Programmes. And this has been specifically in our supply operation, where we have we run virtual sessions for people. It's voluntary, so it's open to everybody. And basically what we do is, so I participate in this as well as some of my colleagues who might, you know, run a factory, or they might run procurement, or they might run supply chain. And we effectively have really gathered together all of the materials and the words of wisdom that people have given us as we've developed our own careers to really try and impart that knowledge into the people who work for us. So there are different seminars. It's a lot about designed to give people confidence to try things differently, to kind of go for promotions where they might naturally see many, many reasons why not to. And I think one of the things, we've had hundreds of people have signed up for that in the last couple of years. And I think it's our main mission around it is actually to try and kind of give people the confidence to really try and experiment with different things. And the thing that really strikes people, I think, is no two people's stories are the same. And I think some of the feedback that we've had from people is about a little bit about the mindset rather than think. We get a lot of feedback from some of our female employees that they see many reasons why maybe things aren't possible. So they've got caring accountabilities or they make assumptions about what it must be like to do one of these senior jobs and almost sort of self-select out. So we do quite a lot of work to try and encourage people to think, you know, well, what would have to be the conditions for me to be able to succeed in that role? And so really trying to kind of build people's confidence around that and give them mentors and coaches that can help think about what do I want to do and how am I going to do it is pretty fundamental to many of the things that we do. I think other people have mentioned targets and things. We've also had that as well. We've got about 40% of our kind of executive committee now for Diageo are women. And we've spent a lot of time, I think, actually trying to redress gender balance, particularly in the kind of management Marina, and I think that we've done that very successfully, actually, when you look at some of the numbers. However, for the part of the business that I'm accountable for, you know, it is manufacturing and operations, and it's still quite quite male-dominated in some of our kind of particular areas of production and things. A lot of shift working, because we're 24/7 operations, and we know probably only about 1 in 4 of our shift workers will be female. So we're, you know, at the moment we're trying to kind of run focus groups and things, again, to get insights into thinking, you know, what are some of the things that we really could be working on to address that balance, and how could we make something a bit more possible. Maybe the only other couple of examples to give you, we know in the supply chain operation it is more difficult. You get a lot less applications from people coming in because way back in the system, you know, less people are just taking the right subjects to go into STEM, and so it goes on. I'm sure you've heard that from many people. So we actually ran an event last year where we asked other companies, other organisations, you know, some of the people here came to that event to kind of say we've all got the same challenges in this arena, so to try and learn from each other, to sort of see, you know, what are some of the other things that we might kind of think about. So I think it's such a complex kind of area, and there are so many things that you could do. Again, I think that's where data helps, to really try and pinpoint what are some of the things that we really want to achieve. And maybe just one other final theme would be, as I say, we have a lot of people and they stay with us for a long time. Some functions, it's very easy to recruit women. And if you look into the different, you know, functions within your business, you will see that some have got a very healthy balance, some have got more women than men. So the other thing that we're trying to kind of say is, well, what could we maybe do to encourage a bit more cross-functional movement? So, okay, yeah, maybe I didn't take physics or something at school, but, you know, well, certainly for me, school would be a long time ago. And so therefore, you know, what are some of the other opportunities that you might create for people to do different kinds of roles? And some of our other policies about trying to document, you know, what's required in a role, you know, what are our kind of cross-functional skills that you might have to bring in, you know, as a team leader into an operational area. Maybe you haven't had the functional capability or the functional knowledge beforehand, but that's something that we can give you skills in, and you can utilise your leadership in different areas. So that's some of the things that we're sort of trying to encourage around that at the moment.
I'd ask that question. That was fantastic. Thank you.
John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I think kind of following on from Julian Martin's questions, I mean, I was interested that, I think it was Scottish Water, modern apprentices, you're getting a lot more women in, but the national figures are not good with modern apprentices. It still seems to be very traditional. Are you effectively extracting more women from a small pool? Or is it your impression there are gradually more women coming through?
I think the pool is a big pool, because it's about half of the Scottish public that we've got, you know, in terms that we can pull upon. I think what's helped enormously is what is an apprentice? So the move away from that always meaning a traditional operational apprentice that's typically being male dominated. I think Scottish Water now, I think we've got 27 different types of modern apprenticeship that people can apply for and do, and we have everything through from foundation apprenticeship through to graduate modern apprenticeships now. So when you vary the types of modern apprenticeships that people can apply for, it can in itself make it much more attractive for females to consider. But I think what also helps is in Scotland's Modern Apprenticeship Week, which happened quite recently, we were almost exclusively profiling female modern apprentices on social media and in advertising, just to get the message out there that these sorts of roles are attractive roles, they are interesting roles for young women to consider, and look how someone is doing it now. So So no, I don't think the pool is a small one. I think it's the sector hasn't been great at showing that it can be and is interesting and stimulating and a positive place for young women to apply to. And that's what we're really focusing on. And that's what I know Energy and Utility Skills are focusing on when they're looking at this more nationally.
Okay. I mean, STEM's been mentioned, and that was the kind of area I'm interested in. You can obviously, well, you can encourage girls to apply at the apprenticeship stage. What I'm wondering is, where should we be trying to intervene or do more to have change girls' thinking, if you like? And it's not just them, it's maybe it's families as well.
Yes.
Is it at secondary school level? Is it at primary school level? Is it even at nursery? I mean...
Yeah, my personal view is as early as possible. There's been a piece of interesting research done that if you talk about engineering-type roles and call them design... That in itself makes engineering roles much more attractive to women. So, because you're starting to create a connection between art and design. So often it's some of the language, some of the terminology that's used that can actually shut someone's thinking off about the possibility of those sorts of roles before they're even aware of what those roles are. You don't study engineering at school, so people, boys and girls, have very, very little appreciation until much later about what that even means. So I think there is a look at what's on the curriculum, at what point are young children allowed to drop away from maths? At what point are they allowed to drop away from the sciences? And you could argue, one might argue, that's perhaps too early.
I mean, what do others think about the age thing? I mean, that would suggest if people are choosing subjects, maybe S2, that kind of level is quite a kind of crucial age. Is that what?
Yeah, I've got a boy at that stage right now, but... That's where we've gone with the Teach First initiative. So it's secondary school, it's kind of 11, 12-year-old. It's encouraging people at the career choice stage. However, that said, I think our learning through this is the younger you can get in, the better. So a piece of work one of our groups of engineers have just done, actually, is to create a workbook for school children, and it's aged up to 7. It's called Keeping the Lights On, and the good thing about it is the engineer in the book is a female. So that's great. But this is something that we've bought into when our females are going out into schools to go and help inspire the younger generation. They're taking these booklets with them. It's got some workbooks in there. It's great. But I think that's one thing we have learned, that earlier is probably better.
Actually family influence, because I think it's all very well talking to the children themselves, but actually if they're then going home and talking to their parents and their parents are saying that's not a job for girls, that's not a job for boys, then that good work is undone. So I think, you know, more can be done by organisations and others to ensure that parents are a bit more open to the possibilities that may not have been open to them when they were young but are now open.
I mean, we're talking about different sectors too, and I mean the other three I guess are traditionally male-dominated. Sodexo, I wonder, though, do you have sectors that are quite female-dominated within your company?
So we're a facilities management company, so we do catering, cleaning, facilities management. Some of the roles are quite technical, and we would see that sometimes there is more of a male dominance in those particular areas, you know, as has been described by some of my colleagues. Really, it does depend on the individual sector, but from an overall Sodexo perspective, we're gender balanced up until the senior management team, and that's why we've got those specific targets in place for that population.
I remember who it was it Scottish Water that said you've got sectors which are more male dominated than others?
We have occupational segregation at Scottish Water, which means we have roles which are almost 100% filled by males, and we have other roles that are almost 100% filled by females. So that's why we try to get underneath the actual statistics and look at that occupational segregation and see what we can do about that.
So it's part of the answer to get men into some of these roles. That's why I was focusing on Sodexo, because I thought maybe you had sectors like that where we actually, as well as getting women into the male roles, we get our traditionally seen as male roles, we get men more into some of these other roles as well.
And I think that's really important, you know, particularly if we look at things like the caring professions, if we look at the national statistics on that, you know, what we see is that, you know, as you rightly say, women do tend to be more in those childcare and indeed healthcare type positions. So I think for us, it's about balance. It's around gender balance. It's not just about women, it's not just about men, but it's how do we get gender balance within the occupational groups and within the levels of the hierarchy.
Okay, thank you.
And a question from Gordon MacDonald.
Wanted to ask Shirley about the evidence you gave about closing the gender pay gap. At the bottom of page one, it says the causes of any normal pay gap are complex, with the greatest driver being occupational segregation, followed by length of service and age. Now, you've talked quite a lot about how you're going to handle and deal with the occupational segregation. What, if anything, can you do about the other two aspects?
So our length of service our average length of service is just under 20 years. And our turnover, particularly in the big operational parts of Scottish Water, are just over 2%. So whatever you attempt to do, it's quite difficult to eke into those areas if you have permanent employees in those roles for a long time. I mentioned earlier something very interesting that we did last year, which was to begin... We created a central fund of money, not an enormous amount of money, but a central fund of money, and then did a promotional campaign to particularly target it at that part of the business to say, are you at a point in your career where you might wish to consider flexibly retiring? And that actually, for many people, is an enormous benefit, not something problematic, because actually the transition to full retirement can be quite a brutal thing for some people when they've always worked full time. And we had a lot of interest in that scheme, the notion of flexible retirement. And to date, we have, I think it's about 60 men from that part of the business now working flexibly. Now, what that means is they might reduce to 2 or 3 days a week. We buddy them with a modern apprentice. Often that modern apprentice will be female. They're sharing knowledge and wisdom between themselves. We also get in return a fixed retirement date from that individual. It's an obligation, if you flexibly retire, to state a fixed retirement date. So that gives us certainty then in terms of manpower planning and budgeting, and it allows you just very slowly to begin to eke in and make changes to that part of the business. And it's gone down really positively, and it's something that we will probably repeat.
COSLA mentioned similar aspects, and I just wonder what the other panel members were doing and what their length of service on average was in staff turnover.
Our length of service would be kind of similar to that. Our turnover is very low. Again, just because, you know, people come and they stay for a long time, so we probably face the same kind of challenges as Shirley was outlining there.
So the point I was coming to was PwC's Women at Work Index, which was published in February 2017, suggested that on historic trends, the gender pay gap in the UK, currently at 17%, might not close until around 2040. So, I mean, is that a realistic target, and how do we reduce that target?
I think, looking at our trends, and I don't know if I speak for the other panel members as well, movement is slow, and a lot of this is about cultural change as well. You know, we've talked a lot about getting women in, and that's really encouraging. But what we don't want to do is get a lot of difference in, and nobody know how to handle that. And it's not that women need to be handled differently, but people need to understand, if you're in a majority of one gender or another, or one majority and a small minority, it's how you get the best and you enable that difference. And so we've put a lot of effort into that. And it's that awareness of our own bias that we all have. We've introduced hiring manager training, which focuses in on that, and unconscious personal bias. And we are making that mandatory. So anybody who's involved in hiring, looking at internal promotions, they will go through this training. And these are all small starts, but really important steps to take. There's a reason why the job title's inclusion and diversity for me, because we see that the difference, the diversity that's coming, whether we like it or not, with the demographical changes, it's the different, it's the cultural change piece, the inclusion that's so important to get right. I think there's some tactical moves you could make, and there's some research out there that says you could nail it in 10 years. So things like the flexible working, you know, if we all had a spotlight on that and really challenged ourselves with some of the roles, not just at the lower end of the pay scale, but higher up as well, could they be done in a different way that would welcome a broader spectrum of people applying, then that would really help things.
I think we can all do all and take part and pursue all the initiatives that we've been discussing here today internally, but we also need to play a significant part externally as well. So as part of the Wood Review, the Developing Scotland's Young Workforce, there was a proposal in that every organisation should enter into a partnership with a school in Scotland for between 3 and 5 years. And Scottish Water has done that. We partner with St Andrew's School in Glasgow. To date, we've delivered 1,000 different interactions with that school. And we're now at the point where 38% of girls said they selected science subjects as a consequence of those interactions and that relationship. But it's one school. And we only have the capacity to connect with one school, but we've given a huge amount of support and attention to that school. I just wonder whether every organisation is doing that, and there's more we could do to encourage that, because I think there has to be a societal effect so that we don't just play our part internally, but we're doing what we need to do externally as well.
We obviously need to get more people into STEM, so are you aware of how many other companies and organisations like yourself is carrying out that work with schools?
I'm not sure.
No.
Sodexo perspective, we would absolutely welcome a continued partnership with, you know, business, other businesses, education and the government in promoting this work. We recognise that it's multifaceted, as my colleagues have said. It's about getting to children when they're young. It's around bringing in more women. It's around developing more women, and it's around retaining more women. And I think, you know, that has to continue to be the focus. And from a personal perspective, I find it incredibly depressing to think that it might not be until 2040 that we're going to close the gender pay gap. But I think the more you look into this, the more you see how complex it is. And I think that's why a partnership approach is really going to be critical. Just to pick up on the role models piece, one of the things that we've done through our women's network within Sodexo, recognising the impact that role models can have, but actually how difficult it is for sometimes people to actually get their story out there. We've done a couple of things. So our women's network run podcasts, and those podcasts are people telling their own personal story, and they tend to be people who are in non-traditional roles. And those podcasts are publicly available. So they're downloadable via iTunes, and that's something that's received really positive feedback, both from our own internal employees, but also from people externally who can also download them. And I think, you know, the other sort of party within the partnership approach, which I believe we need to take, which I think it would be important to call out, would be the role of awards organisations who really profile women who are perhaps doing non-traditional roles or who are really pushing the boundaries in terms of the work that they do. So that, again, is something that we find incredibly helpful, and that we would absolutely encourage that to continue.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a stark message that you raise there, and I think for me it comes down to kind of leadership and resolve. So that may well be the case if we carry on doing, you know, what we've always done. But I think in terms of trying to sort of see some of these points that get made, I think that does encourage more creativity and, you know, more kind of leadership and resolve, as I say, to actually see that's not an outcome that we want. So therefore, you know, what kind of changes is that going to require for us to make? And some of which may seem unimaginable at the moment, but I think, you know, I've worked in I've worked in business for quite a long time now, and if I even sort of reflect back to what it was like when I first started to work versus what it's like now, you know, I think if you've got real resolve and positivity to change, then, you know, I think it's in our hands to really drive a different outcome.
One thing we've not touched upon at all is and it does have an effect, is who remains the person who has the principal responsibility for childcare. So although 96% of our women on maternity leave return, the numbers of men taking paternity leave has been completely flat in our organisation since 2014. So just approximately 63 men a year will ask for paternity leave and take it. But the average amount of leave they take is 26 days. Now, you could argue that's not particularly shared in terms of raising children and responsibility for children. So again, there's the effect of all of that on a woman in the workplace in terms of who should share the childcare arrangements. And I'm aware, for example, in Europe, the certain countries who are looking at incentivising the taking of paternity leave or even mandating the taking of paternity leave. Now, I'm not suggesting that for a moment, but I just found this statistic we had with the percentage of people asking for it has remained very flat.
And is there any reason why it's remained flat? I mean, is it a cultural issue? Or,
no, I don't think so.
No?
It's on offer, so I don't think so. Maybe we need to storytell a bit more in terms of where it's been done successfully.
Okay.
So my view would be that's probably an area where it's a cultural issue within the UK, so not specific to organisations. I think it's still quite unusual for men to be the primary caregivers. You've only got to turn up at any school gates, and actually the number of men that you see there is very limited. So, you know, I think it's a bigger issue than within specific organisations.
Okay, thanks.
I suppose it's also a matter of personal choice and how families choose to organise themselves. Is that, I mean, as I think Shirley Campbell said, you have the option there, but to a certain extent, people make choices, whether men or women, on how they organise their lives.
Yeah, and I think the green shoot for us has been seeing the number of males in part-time roles double over just a few years. So I think that suggests that they're working more flexibly because they're also playing a part in carer responsibilities.
Mm-hmm. We'll come now to a question from Ash Denham.
I was actually going to ask you a question about innovative practices, but I think that's been well covered in answer to Gillian Martin's question. So I'll put this to you. I don't know if anybody's seen recently Aviva, so that's the insurance company. They wrote to all their suppliers and threatened to cancel contracts with them if these supplier companies didn't have progression routes for women or didn't have women in senior roles. And I'm just interested to hear what your comments might be on that.
I perhaps have the inside track on this a little bit because I worked with Aviva for 12 years in human resources, and I still have a lot of contacts there. I think the way that was publicised in the press and how that was stated is not appropriate. It was perhaps too threatening in its approach and something of a blunt instrument. I think it is always a positive thing to encourage very good working practices in the supply chain. And that covers a whole plethora of things from modern slavery, human trafficking, to gender equality, et cetera, et cetera. So the relationships we have and the sharing of good working practices and the expectation that they also adopt them is incredibly positive. But I personally don't think it's positive to resort to threats of cancellations of arrangements.
I would agree with that. I think through our supply chain, we're a living wage employer, and we encourage that through our supply chain. But parts of our business are also, you know, looking to win contracted work, and we see an increasing amount of questionnaires coming through as part of those tender processes, asking us, you know, what are your stats, what are you doing, what evidence do you have, what policies do you have. So I see a trend in asking for more transparency with that, and I think that's a good thing.
That onto your supply chain then, ask them to sort of show that what their practices are.
It's something we're working with procurement at the moment. You know, if our internal ambitions are this, then we'd be expecting similar. We'd want to see that demonstrated in the people who are offering us a service. Mm-hmm.
We'd probably even look beyond our supply chain. So we're very open around the work that we do on gender balance, and indeed we're quite transparent as an organisation. So we're very open to sort of sharing what it is that we're doing in this space, and indeed others. So we've already done a number of events where we've shared our kind of policies and approaches with both clients and suppliers, but indeed other organisations, because I think they've also got an opportunity to learn and share best practice.
Yeah, very similar. I think, you know, more and more you looking at partnerships with your suppliers and things. So I think it's very important that that we're aligned on some of these things. So I just echo the points that have been made, really.
And finally, this one more for Rosie MacRae. This I noticed in your submission you talked about a sort of a skills gap that you felt was looming, and that you'd identified that there was possibly a pool of women that had skills, maybe not exactly the right skills to fit that, and that you felt with the right sort of support and encouragement that those women could be brought on to maybe, you know, partially at least fill that skills gap. Could you talk a little bit more about what you're doing there?
Yes, we're learning in that space, but sort of female returnships, which I think you had Talat Yakubin talking from Equate Scotland. So we were partnering with her together with the Prospect Union, and they have this pool of women who have been out of the workplace for whatever reason for a number of years and are STEM qualified. So it's looking at offering them work placements from 3 to 12 months. And we did two of those last year, very successful. And one of the ladies actually just got in touch with me and said she's since gone on to another organisation and, you know, acquired full-time permanent work, which is great. I think we can do more of that. And especially, and we're all learning in this space, I think, when we look at some of the stats of our female workforce and those over 50. So I talked earlier about, you know, women being commonly in roles where the progression points aren't as many as the technical skilled roles, and that's a challenge. But one thing I learnt only last week was that the dominance of women over 50 who are in education and health and retail, and in those areas, you know, the opportunities to progress are sort of slimmer than others, and they're probably vastly skilled as well. So if we're serious about this, we really need to get behind the numbers, understand just where our women are at, what skills they have, and probably look to do some positive action, I think, at a larger scale.
Have you any idea what that might look like, or is it too early to say?
So one thing, it was a few months ago now, I was at a session, and it was all about strategic thinking. In Germany, they're doing things, it's called rent-a-pensioner, it's called rent-a-rentner, rent-a-pensioner, where pensioners are kind of going onto this website and saying, these are all the skills that I have, I'm up for working 2 days a week, 3 days a week. It's actually taking a lot of pressure off the government with pension payments. It's keeping a healthy, elderly, you know, group of people out there. And it's working fantastically well. And I was really encouraged by that. And I also think if you marry that up with what you know about your business, you could have great things. You know, when we first started looking at this, a lot of what we learned was by holding a mirror up and understanding who our customers are. Lots of our domestic customers in SSE are elderly. And yet we look at our retail business, and a lot of the people who are dealing with them on the phone are under 35. So that was our first piece of inclusive work we did around having inclusive conversations with people that are at a different generation from you. But why are we not targeting people at that age category who may have more in common? It was things like that I think we need to get a little bit more creative around.
Well, I mentioned earlier that we have long-term succession pipelines. We have a 10-year programme looking at future leaders and future senior leaders, and a big percentage of that cohort are women, young women. If you are offered a place on that 10-year development programme, a commitment is that you must permit managed moves internally on your behalf. And that's proven to be quite interesting, but what it means over the 10-year programme is that the organisation will determine for you what is your next move from a development perspective. So for women in particular who can be quite hesitant about putting themselves forward for a next move, the organisation does it for them. So they must do a role in change, they must do a leadership role, they must do a customer facing role, and they must do a commercial role. And that's something that they're aware of if they enter into the 10-year development programme. So again, it helps develop quite a diverse skills mix just as a consequence of those moves being managed on their behalf.
Question from Richard Leonard.
Thanks very much, Convener. There is a group of workers that we haven't really touched on, but some of them are employed by Megan Horsburgh's organisation. And these, I suspect, will be the lowest paid workers that maybe aren't employed by you, but are employed for you. They will be contracted out. They will be cleaners and catering workers and others in facilities management. I mean, could you reflect or could you share with us your policy and experience as an organisation on this group of workers, the lowest paid workers?
Yeah, absolutely. So from an organisational perspective, you know, like others have said, we absolutely have a commitment to being a living wage employer. So that was one of the commitments that we've made recently, because we recognise that those individuals are our lowest paid within our organisation. But I think in terms of our organisational approach, they're really the lifeblood of our organisation, and we know that the skills that people develop in those customer-facing roles are really critical to actually moving into more senior management positions. So we know that an ability to have conversations with people and to have that customer-facing experience are actually really vital to moving into more senior management positions. And like the other organisations have described, we have a long length of service on average within our organisation. And what we see is that often people will move from some of those more junior positions actually into more senior positions. And if I may share a story from one of our regional leadership committee, he actually joined our organisation in one of those lower level positions, and he now sits on our UK and Ireland regional leadership team. So we've got some great examples of career progression and perhaps people taking career paths that you wouldn't necessarily expect. You know, people doing things that actually go against some of the gender stereotypes that we've been talking a lot about today.
So you say that you are a living wage employer, so everybody employed by Sodexo in Scotland is on a living wage?
So we have signed up to the concept of the living wage, and through the bids that we have with our clients have a choice as to whether they sign up to that or not with us. But absolutely, we agree with the concept of the living wage, and we think it's really important for people's quality of life that you know, they are paid a fair wage and they get those career development opportunities as well. It's not only about the here and now, but it's also about actually what does the future look like for them.
So you're a living wage employer on paper, but actually people that are employed by Sodexo are not necessarily being paid the living wage.
We would have an aspiration that our employees would absolutely be paid the living wage, and that is a decision that is ultimately taken by our clients, but it is something that we absolutely support as an organisation.
And what about the staff in the Scottish Parliament? Do they get paid the living wage?
I'm not familiar with the details of that contract, but very happy to come back to you on that.
Okay. And what about in Diageo, for example? Are your contracted out catering and cleaning workers paid the living wage?
Yeah, I think, well, we're in discussions with Sodexo on that at the moment. Well, obviously, from a living wage perspective, in terms of our direct workforce and things, they're all covered by that, including our apprentices and things. So I think it is something that we're actively in discussion with at the moment.
But do you feel it falls within your corporate social responsibility, for example, to ensure that people working on your sites, providing those services, are paid a living wage?
Yeah, I mean, we're very committed to the living wage concept, as I've already said. And I think that in relation to many of the third parties that we've got working on our sites, they're kind of more than covered by that. And if there are any other ones, then, you know, clearly that's something that we need to address.
But what is the currently hourly rate of pay for a cleaner or a contract catering worker on your Leven site or your Shield Hall site, for example?
So I don't have that information.
Could you perhaps supply that to us?
Yeah.
Thanks. I don't know whether, I mean, SSE are a living wage employer. You're an accredited living wage employer, are you not? So what does that mean for any catering or cleaning staff that you employ?
Yeah.
Or are employed on your sites, I should say.
So all our direct employees are living wage or more. And we champion it through our supply chain. So some of our catering staff are contracted out and we champion the living wage through our supply chain.
Does that mean they get paid the living wage or not?
I wouldn't know. I would imagine in some cases they do and some they don't. I don't have that data with me. We could supply it.
And Scottish Water?
Yeah, we're also an accredited living wage employer. We've also looked at the contracts that that we have. At the point we became an accredited living wage employer, there were either two or three contracts that had not yet come up for renewal. But the endeavour was to ensure at the point of renewal, we would absolutely ensure that those contracts for services providers would give the living wage. As far as I'm aware, there's either one, there might be only one that hasn't yet come up for renewal, the others have. And I'm aware that one of the more recent ones, that meant an increase on the contract cost of £300,000 per annum, which Scottish Water was prepared to accept to ensure that those employees also received the living wage.
Final question: if you're able to find the resources to pay your own direct employees the living wage, isn't it also therefore possible to find the resources to pay for contractors who are supplying services on your sites to be living wage employers and employees?
We do.
Okay.
To bring matters perhaps slightly back to the gender pay gap issue, I think, following on from Richard Leonard's question, if there are sectors of your employees or workforces who are predominantly male or predominantly female, if those sectors are low paid, what are you doing to try and balance things out, as it were? Because I think there's broad agreement that it's a question or a matter of balance, how these things are approached. But I think the key point from a gender pay gap point of view may be that how do you address that issue? Because I think recent studies, some have shown that a lot of the difficulty arises where men's wages are simply getting lower rather than women's wages increasing, and the gender pay gap may be going down for that reason rather than a better reason, which might be that the wages are being brought up to the same mark, as it were. Any comments on that?
I think for us in SSE, again, looking at the numbers and last year reporting on the gender pay gap helped with this. What we found was that whilst we are 30% female in SSE, which is quite good in our industry, the average is 18%, we looked at salary bands and only 10% of our women were in roles earning over 40,000. And that was quite alarming to us. And we kind of knee-jerked into a target around that, quite a hard target, and said we want to see that more than double by 2025. So that's one thing we deliberately went out with. We're also signed up with the Powerful Women Initiative, which was formed out of the previous DEC, the members of government. And with that, we signed up, again, it's not regulatory, but it's our pledge that 40% of our women and 40% of our managers would be women by 2030, and that 30% of our senior managers would be women. So these are things we've found out from our stats and that we've said we want to do better in and have set ourselves a target against.
Certainly for us, rather than see our salaries going down, we've actually seen them increase, and there's been a consequence of that because of the effect of the living wage, so much so at Scottish Water that our banding system, band E for us, is our lowest banding level. That's now collapsed completely into the band above, so we will be eliminating the lowest band that we have typically had at Scottish Water for many, many years, because it's actually had a raised impact and it's all now absorbed within the next level up. So we're looking at our banding arrangements in the future just to make sure we've got the right start rates, end rates and overlaps between the bands, but it's allowed us to take away the lowest rate of pay that we had in our band E.
Thinking, I mean, again, at the end of the day, it comes back to this gender balance issue, isn't it? So I don't think it's about trying to reduce pay or anything. I think, you know, that's, I don't think that's an objective at all. I think it would be more about really trying to encourage, as we've already said, more women into the kind of higher paid jobs as well.
Okay, I'll move on to a question from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. We heard from Shirley Campbell and Rosie in response to the question about Aviva, but do any of you wish to say a bit more about what large corporates like yourselves are doing to improve the gender pay gap in your supply chain?
So from a Sodexo perspective, we haven't yet had a focus specifically on our supply chain, although I think that's an opportunity for us for the future. But we've been incredibly transparent about all of the work that we do around gender balance and also in regard to the gender pay gap figure, which we published last November. And we recognise that actually there's a real advantage to us coming together with other businesses as a community and sharing the good practices. So that's something that we've been doing on an informal basis, and I think it's something that we will continue to do moving forwards, because for us it's not just about our supply chain, although we know there's some large organisations in there. It's actually around how do we move this conversation forward as a, you know, as a UK.
Yeah, and I think for us, you know, we did a piece of work to try and work out, you know, where we're, you know, did we have any kind of issues around there? And I think it would be a commitment to kind of move that forward. So it's actually making sure that we understand what's happening in the different suppliers that we use and, you know, for us to kind of, again, work in partnership with them to make sure that that's a great outcome for everybody.
You said you think it's a commitment. Is it a commitment?
It's definitely something that we have looked at. I think for the vast majority of our suppliers, there isn't an issue. There may be, I think the last time I looked at it, there was maybe one or two, and again, they were in discussion with them to sort that out.
So you're inviting them to report their own gender pay gap, are you? Is that the kind of thing you're looking at when you're procuring?
They would... Well, again, in terms of the reporting piece, I think they will be aligned around the same legislation as the rest of us in terms of reporting.
Although many people in the supply chain will not be covered by the legislation, there'll be less than 250 people.
Okay. Yeah, that's something I need to take away and have a look at.
Okay. On to another question about what the Scottish Government's doing. We've heard a bit of evidence about some work in the Fair Work Convention and also around the Scottish Business Pledge, but that in respect of the gender pay gap, these initiatives are perhaps not achieving a great deal at the moment. Do you feel that the Scottish Government's doing enough on this in terms of the policy levers it has, and what more do you think it could do?
I think on that we are, you know, in agreement with the Scottish Business Pledge. However, when it comes to gender pay gap, I think there is room there to be a bit more specific and a bit more targeted. I think I agree with one of the comments that was made earlier about working together, sort of education, government and employers. I think if we could be focused on the top three or four things that are gathering evidence to really make a difference, if we were all focused in on that, we could make some real change. So I've talked a bit and a few times about the flexible working piece. There's probably more than that, but if we could all be targeted on the same things, and this is where the business pledge, I think, could articulate just more factually what are the things that would make a difference.
For us, I mean, obviously, where could we go further? The way we report as part of the public sector equality duty is one way of stating what your gender pay gap is. The UK approach applied to the private sector and the public sector in England is more onerous in terms of what the requirement is, and it goes into far more detail. So I guess there's a question about whether that might be applicable to apply to the Scottish public sector as well. We would certainly welcome the opportunity to look more forensically at our information. So looking at gender by pay band, gender pay by gap by ethnicity, for example, looking at gender pay gap by age, by length of service, that tells you quite interesting information, and we do that voluntarily and for ourselves, so that we can make sure that our interventions are properly targeted. So I guess there's a question about, you know, what methodology will we be using going forward.
Yeah, again, I think it is about partnership. It's probably about keeping dialogue, you know, between us as well, to try and work out what are the areas that we jointly want to work on, you know, moving forward in. So I think, you know, I mentioned the Not Just for Boys initiative. That was a good one, I think, to kind of help address some of the long-standing issues in terms of, you know, women and things coming into non-traditional organisations. So I think the more that we can see that we could work together on some of those things, I think that would be really helpful.
So I think I've spoken at length about Sodexo's desire for a partnership approach. Probably the one party that I think is really critical to this that perhaps we haven't mentioned so much is actually the role of the media. And I think as more and more companies begin to publish their gender pay gap, I think their role is going to become more critical in actually making sure that the general public actually have a reasonable understanding of the differences between equal pay and the gender pay gap, because I think it's a difficult construct for sort of lay people to get their heads around. And so I think there's a real opportunity for media to contribute positively in that regard.
Thank you.
Quick follow-up question on that. The UK government's return to work scheme that I think is going to come into force in England, is that a good idea? Is that something that might be, I don't think it's proposed at present for Scotland, is that something that might be useful in Scotland? I don't know if any of you have had a chance to consider that. Well, we'll move on then. I think final question from Dean Lockhart, please.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to come back briefly to the discussion on a gender pay gap and progression of women into senior positions and the role organisations can help or the role organisations or programmes can be put in place to help women reintegrate back into the workforce after a career break, either for maternity reasons or otherwise. We've heard evidence from other organisations that having such a programme is critical in making sure that women do progress through into senior positions after a career break. I'd like to briefly get your views on that in terms of what individual organisations can do to achieve this.
I think one of the things I've talked about at length is the percentage of women that we have on our leadership development programmes. It's high. So that's important, and it does look like we're developing quite a healthy pipeline of women that will flow through into senior management positions. We had some examples of individuals needing to go on maternity leave partway through cohort one, but that automatically meant that they came back and went straight on to the next cohort again so they could continue with the development. So there wasn't an issue there. We're also delighted that we've got over 96% of women do return from maternity leave, and quite interestingly, more recently, they're returning to full-time roles more than they did before, because typically that would be in some sort of part-time arrangement, and we believe that's due to the agile working principles that now play across the totality of Scottish Water. To give you a very recent example of something else we've just endorsed, which it's a discussion that we had with the executive team last week, where our suggestion was that every returner to Scottish Water would attend one of our immersion events that we offer to all leaders at Scottish Water, which talks about business strategy, business performance, future direction. So whether they are or are not a leader at the point at which they might have gone on long-term sickness absence or maternity leave or undertaken an international assignment, they will be given the opportunity to participate in that group so that they get a really good kind of context and understanding of where the business is at the point of their return, which should hopefully sort of pump prime them as they go back into their role. So that's just a small other example of something else which we think will be helpful.
Yeah, for us, one of the things we offer is coaching and mentoring to those that are going off paternity and maternity and adoption leave, so pre, during and post. I talked earlier about the hiring manager training and the sort of inclusive approach to that, which has been good. But another win we had was with our most senior leaders, all of whom are men, where they undertook some personal belief coaching on this subject. So they got it. They got the business need to have more difference, but they went through some coaching themselves as to what that meant for them as individuals that they had to change. And I think we can't get away from the importance of that. It's these key decision points and the processes that you have in place, the policies that you have in place at decision points about people progressing or who you're hiring in, that you need to put this lens on, that everybody's balanced. It's thinking about when you're interviewing, do you have a balanced panel there that's, you know, balanced in many different ways, not just on gender, and all these things that we're still working through, but seem to be incredibly important to make the shift that we need.
And I think, you know, for us again, so running programmes or whatever is one aspect of it, but we have very regular talent review processes, kind of annual processes where, you know, we're reviewing people's performance and potential and where they might go. And I think there's a lot more emphasis put on, you know, what do we need to do to kind of further prepare this person for the next step up? And just understanding where, you know, and it's almost like, you know, people's own aspirations and views can change. So I think having a regular review process kind of helps in this regard as well, where you're always updating, you know, where somebody is in their career, you know, what we need to do to enable the next steps for them.
Thank you very much to all of our witnesses. I'm afraid we're well out of time now, so thank you very much. And I'll suspend the sitting just for a minute so we can change the witnesses to the next panel. So, in fact, no one needs to leave from the public gallery. It's just we're changing over witnesses for our next evidence session. Thank you. Well, good morning to everyone. May I welcome our second panel of witnesses. And we have with us from right to left this time, first of all, Katy Miller, who is Head of Human Resources at the City of Edinburgh Council, and I think he's here on behalf of COSLA. Then we have Peter Reekie, who is Deputy Chief Executive and Director of Investments for Scottish Futures Trust. Nicky Page, who is Head of People Management for Police Scotland. Ian Reid, who is the Management Site Secretary for NHS Scotland Terms and Conditions Committee. And finally, Diane Vincent, who is Director of People and Organisational Development for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So welcome to all of you this morning. Thank you for coming. And we'll start with a question from Bill Bowman.
Thank you, Convener. I can ask a question, not so much about your own organisations, but looking at the broader picture. Do you believe that we have a defined set of agreed statistics on female economic activity in Scotland and on the pay gap?
Who would like to start? Ian Reid.
The earlier part of your question, I'm not an expert on, so I wouldn't perhaps comment too directly on that. But in terms of the information that we're now collating in the NHS, it's in a standardised format across all of the NHS boards and is at a level of detail which is much greater than it was even two or three years ago. And as you'll be aware, each NHS board is required to publish that information in this year by April, the end of April 17. So it will be much more in the public domain, I think, what the nuances are within the NHS, and hopefully will help the understanding, because although the NHS is a predominantly female organisation, it still has a gender pay gap for reasons we can perhaps go into. But in terms of the information, I think it's in a much better place than it was two or three years ago.
Thank you. I think similar to the evidence you heard this morning from our private sector colleagues, there perhaps isn't a definitive measure as such, but within the public sector, I do believe that we're all reporting in line with the public sector equality duty, which as I understand it is an average hourly rate of pay, which is minus overtime and allowances. There are other ways of calculating that, but my own view would be that that particular calculation allows some comparisons to be made, and we certainly use that when we're comparing our pay gap with other similar public sector organisations. I do note that in some of the reports there is a tendency to use the median as opposed to the mean, and perhaps that's something that we could consider within the public sector if it's worthy of expanding our reporting to look at not just the average but the median as well.
Peter Reekie.
Speaking as probably a procurer, then when you're thinking about the potential to evaluate on the basis of figures that come forward from organisations, it's really important that they are comparable so that we can make a fair evaluation. And we know that some of the standards of publication, there are pretty clearly set guidelines on what figures have to be used. But from what we hear and read, there are some pretty difficult concepts in there about employees, workers, contractors, owners of businesses, if you're looking at the professional services, and basics, overtimes and allowances that can be different between different organisations within a sector as well as between different sectors. So I think that, for me, that concept of exactly how we collect the figures and whether we'll ever be able to get a set of statistics that are capable of being compared in a sort of procurement and that sort of level of transparency and comparability is really very challenging at the minute, I would say.
Nicky Page.
Thank you. Certainly we find that within policing we've got a very good kind of grip of our police officer data. We are partway through our modernisation for staff because, as the committee will be aware, Police Scotland came together 4 years ago. As a result of that, we inherited 10 different legacy pay systems. That gives us particular challenges in terms of the look across. However, that being the case, we still had an attempt in the current and published mainstreaming report to look at segregation and horizontal segregation. We did use the benchmark of kind of salaries for staff to give us some work to build on for future years. In terms of the wider question that was asked around data, what we certainly find challenging is when we look for benchmarks and comparators, as Diane's already pointed out, the very basic information is very comparable within the public sector, I would say. However, as soon as you get into the more challenging aspects of looking at segregation, age, service levels, and how these things affect pay, that's much more difficult, because when you do look at other organisations, because there isn't specifics, and different bodies give you kind of different indicators of how to calculate it, that is much more challenging. And for us to learn from other organisations, it's useful to have common benchmarks, and that's maybe something that we all have to work on in the public sector and in different industries at large.
Katy Miller.
What Nicky has just said, that at a surface level, then yes, there is consistency across the measurements. But actually, when you start to look at some of the dynamics that sit underneath that, so for example, the propensity for men to work longer hours during a week, some reports would argue that perhaps they earn overtime four times as much as women within a working week, etc. So it's when you start to look at the next level of detail below the surface level, then that's when the dynamics really start to come in, I think.
I think what you're saying is that within your organisations where you have them, you're really reasonably comfortable that you're producing information for your own use, but reliable benchmarking across other organisations might not be so easy. Yes. Yeah? Okay.
Ash Denham?
Obviously, we've got the forthcoming pay gap reporting legislation that's going to be coming in. And so I'm wondering what the panel's views on whether just that act of having to report those statistics will actually create change.
I think the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have found the pay gap reporting useful in terms of making us fully understand what our pay and reward systems are providing for our employees, and also where we've had to take action to address pay gap. So, for example, similar to Police Scotland, we had 9 legacy organisations coming to 1 national organisation also in 2013. And within our support staff functions, we inherited 19 different payroll systems and 9 different pay and grading systems. So our 2013 pay gap analysis and our equal pay report allowed us to focus in on that. And we've spent the last 2 or 3 years really focusing on the pay and reward framework to reduce that pay inequality within the previous systems, bringing in a new HR payroll system and bringing a new pay and reward system that's based on a single job evaluation scheme, which we actually use the COSLA Scottish Joint Council scheme for that. So not just publishing the data was useful, but it helped us focus in on some of the key things that we also had to do. We also used our 2013 report to start to take us into a review of the wider positive action initiatives that we might need to take, and I'm sure the committee might have some questions on that as we go forward. So to answer your question, the reporting of the data is useful. I think it helps promote us as an employer of choice. It helps to show transparency in our pay and reward systems, but it also actually makes us focus internally on the types of action that we need to take in order to reduce any pay inequality and reduce the pay gap and gender, the gender pay gap.
I think in the NHS, it's already started to make an impact, because one of the most stark observations when you looked at the data a few years back was the impact that medical and dental staff have on skewing the gender pay gap. And that, as you'll be aware, is a traditionally male profession, and also the highest paid in the NHS. So that was skewing the gender pay gap quite significantly. Pay is unlikely to alter very much, but the way that we employ doctors is beginning now to be looked at in a much more flexible way. So the kind of long hours culture and everything that went along with that, we're trying to address. And younger women who are coming into the medical profession no longer want to work those kind of rigid fixed hours, and so we're having to look at greater flexibility, more part-time working, and that goes across not only the hospital sector but into general practice. And you'll probably be aware of a lot of work that's going on around multidisciplinary team working, so that the GP, for example, can be part of the team supported by nurses, physios, etc. And that's a way of getting more female employees into the workforce and sustaining them in the workforce in a particularly demanding area.
Yeah, in terms of whether the duty will or will not make a difference, what I can comment on is if we look back at our 2013 published data and we look at our data now, for police officers we had a 7% gap, we're now at a 4% gap, or 4.1% gap anyway, and for police staff we've also made a 1% progress. Now, with police staff we've got a challenge because of the modernisation of the pay and grading system, but we would anticipate with the modernisation of that system will make further progress with police staff. So I think, to echo both Diane and Ian's point, I think it focuses the mind, it focuses activity, and because of that you've got obviously much more chance of actually achieving something if you've got actions in place to do that. So we definitely feel that the duty to publish, the duty to promote is making a difference, certainly in policing, and I would anticipate that that benefit has to happen in other sectors as well, as that duty is better understood and progressed.
So I agree with all of what's been said. I think there's two points, isn't there? The first is what's measured is managed. There's, go back to management thinker Peter Drucker, I think if it isn't being measured, it won't be managed. So I agree. And I think the transparency point and the reporting of it is really important as well. I think some of the impact of Lord Davis's 2011 report on women on the board, and probably not wide enough and not far enough yet, but the rate of change, I believe, did pick up quite significantly when people had to publish their information. So there's something inherently competitive about particularly corporates, and they're trying to compete for talent, compete for customers, compete for shareholders and peer approval. So if we make people publish this information on a comparable basis, then I do believe leadership attention will be drawn to it and people will want to do the right thing to be compared against their peers positively. So both measurement and transparency and publication, I think, are important to drive change.
I'm in agreement. I think it does focuses the mind. There's obviously the dynamics that sit underneath that we should absolutely be exploring and probably be more transparent about. And actually, in terms of partnership working, ultimately, I think if we were to look at our strategies, we're probably all trying to achieve the same things and move in the same direction. So it's actually how we work in partnership across organisations to support each other with that.
So just to summarise, you think that just seeing it there in black and white draws the mind, draws the focus to, you know, the situation, which then leads to a want to kind of improve it. So would you agree, are all of your organisations kind of setting targets for improvement year on year?
Again, just to a recent board meeting I attended, it was at NHS 24, when the quality data was presented and the actions coming from it. There was a great debate amongst the non-executive directors of that particular organisation about what this was telling them and what they might want to put in place. So I think it does open up people's minds, and now there's an action plan against that that will be measured and monitored going forward. So I think it does help in terms of the accountability, I suppose, of these issues, that the data has actually then been discussed at the very senior, at the senior levels.
Just to pick up on that point, I wouldn't say that within the fire service we're setting targets necessarily to improve it, but we are, similar to Ian, putting in the action plans that support what we're trying to do around positive action and the gender pay gap, and those are kept under scrutiny by both our staff governance committee, well, our senior leadership team, our staff governance committee, and the wider Scottish Fire and Rescue Service Board.
Maybe a point slightly different for I come from a relatively small organisation, and I think in that sort of environment we need to be really careful of driving the change through numbers specifically, because we're hit by the statistics of small numbers. So one appointment in one role or another, be a male or a female, can cause some really lumpy, bumpy, weird things to happen to the numbers that aren't really reflective of what's happening in the organisation. So we try and focus on the change we're making and what we do on a day-to-day basis rather than setting targets by numbers.
Sorry, just to add to that, I think what's important in policing is we set outcomes and we look to achieve those outcomes. So it's not driven by numbers, which, as Peter's already pointed out, can skew behaviours and be quite detrimental to culture if you're not very careful. But we do look to see that's the outcome we're trying to achieve. And similar to both Ian and Diane, the Scottish Police Authority looked at the mainstreaming report on the 22nd of March, and they scrutinised that through the year, and they are very interested in looking at where we're progressing in terms of our outcomes.
Thank you. We now come to a question from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I just wonder if you could put on the record your latest gender pay gap figures for your organisation and what the trend's been in recent years.
Our overall gender pay gap for the whole of our employee population is around 5%. We are predominantly a uniform service, so that percentage is driven by the population and our uniform staff. Within our support staff, it is sitting around 15% at the moment. And since we published the report in 2015, the pay gap has gone from 11% organisationally down to 5%, which we're just about to publish in April.
Ours are as in our mainstreaming report, which was published, as I say, just recently. The gap for police officers, excluding allowances and overtime, is 4.1%. And when you add those in, it's 5.8%. In terms of police staff, it is 12%. And when you add in allowances and overtime, it's 13%. So that's where we're sitting with that just now.
In the NHS, it's not collated across the whole of the NHS, but it's done at individual board level. And it varies quite dramatically. So again, we're in boards, the figure I've got here is for Ayrshire and Arran, where they have a high proportion, again, of nursing staff and of medical staff in comparison to some others, it's at 26%. Whereas in NHS 24, which was the other organisation that I looked at, where there's a lower proportion of directly employed medical staff, it's at 3.5%. So quite a significant difference depending on the makeup of the particular workforce in each of the employing boards.
Our pay gap reporting is done by grade. So it's broken down individually by grade, and probably similar to Ian, it looks different across different grades. We have a very different profile of staff within different grades. They're all within the EHRC 3% guideline. So they range from, just looking here, from a 0% to a 1.8%. So I think what I would say within Edinburgh City of Council, we've recently restructured. So we've had about 900 voluntary redundancies in the last 12 months. So therefore, we have actually seen quite a significant shift in terms of the organisational structures and roles within those structures in terms of grading and new people coming in and some people choosing to leave.
Okay, but on City of Edinburgh Council, you have an overall figure as well, though.
We do. So our overall figure is 9%, which is a downward trend compared to the last reporting.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for that. Could you also perhaps say something about the kind of measures you're putting in place to tackle the gender pay gap, to eliminate it?
Yeah, that again. Again, like similar organisations in the public sector, we're slightly constrained due to the pay arrangements because they are nationally negotiated, and in the NHS, the majority of staff are on agenda for change, but a large cohort of the medical staff are on national terms and conditions. All of the progression in the NHS is through length of service or seniority. So again, if people take time out of the workforce, then they'll come back in at a lower level. So there are challenges there, I think, as well. But on a more strategic basis, for medicine, the number of females now at university is now over 50%, where they were underrepresented. So there are things happening at a training level. Each NHS board has modern apprenticeship schemes, and again, I'm making sure that they're gender balanced. We've introduced flexibilities such as shared parental leave that other organisations have. And we're also encouraging, we've got a flexible working policy that encourages flexible working so that if people are returning, they can return on a more flexible basis. I think in the NHS, it's also probably quite important to say that we have a partnership model of employee relations. So the trade unions have appointed equality officers in most of the boards who are also working with managers and taking forward the various strategies and plans that are being put in place. And then the only final area I would maybe highlight is, again, for women coming through to very senior positions in the NHS. Again, they were predominantly male dominated, but there's been a lot of leadership development for senior female staff, and also a women's monitoring network, so that those who are in senior positions can support other women coming through the organisation in order to make sure the gender balance is correct at the higher levels as well.
So for police staff, we've got a programme of modernisation of terms and conditions, because as I've already alluded to, in inheriting those 10 different pay systems, that's given us a number of issues. So we anticipate that that will make a big difference in terms of pay. In addition to that, under the provision of the public sector pay policy, and just in our last pay settlement, the trade union brought forward a proposal as part of that kind of joint work through negotiation that we were doing to raise the pay for those that were under the Scottish Living Wage at that point in time, to put that in a position where that will take them considerably above that position, so we shouldn't have a problem for the next few years anyway. So we endorsed that proposal, and that was part of our pay settlement. In addition to that, we're doing a lot of work just now to try and tackle the differences that might arise from occupational segregation and the opportunities to earn, you know, allowances. In that, we have done a lot of work around a day in the life. We have run taster sessions. So in our operational support division and our specialist crime division, we find that they're less attractive to women. We've done a lot of activities, so taster sessions, so as people can go along to, for example, roads policing, try out, you know, the motorbike there. We historically had issues where, for example, people were put off by equipment. So the fact that it was bigger bikes, and a woman would go along and go, well, this isn't for me because it's too heavy. So we've changed our equipment, we've adapted our equipment to make it more kind of female friendly, if you will. In addition to that, some of the equipment in certain aspects of policing is different. People worry about, will they be able to handle it? So those taster sessions allow them to put on that equipment, try it out, and realise that, yes, they can absolutely cope with that, and, yes, it is a career option for them. In addition to that, we've done a lot of engagement on the other side to encourage flexibility within our kind of male staff as well. We still are male-dominated in the policing side, certainly. So we've done engagement with the Fathers Network to encourage flexible work, and not only for our females, which is obviously, we are reporting that's predominantly where we get our applications. But if we're to help society change from women taking on all the care and responsibility, or the majority of it, we equally have a social responsibility to look at how we can encourage our males to be in a position to feel that they can also take some of that burden. So working with the Fathers Network in our U division, which for those not familiar with policing, that's our Ayrshire. We've run recently a few exercises. First, we've been looking at expectant parents, both male and female, raising awareness of flexible working, raising awareness of sort of care provisions. We've got an EAP that helps advise both males and females on care provisions and how they might manage childcare going forward. The other session that we've ran in U Division recently is around, we worked very closely with the Scottish Women's Development Forum about returners to work, because that also affects our pay. And women, particularly after maternity leave or career break, would find it quite intimidating to come back to the workplace. So again, a lot of work done to integrate those workers back in very well. But in addition to that, the nature of policing is that when somebody gets pregnant, we quite often have to take them off those direct operational duties, you know, trying to get body armour over somebody's heavily expectant bump is quite difficult. So on that basis, you know, we have to look, and we've worked very well with the Scottish Women's Development Forum at making sure that when we do have to pull away from frontline duties, there's still very meaningful roles for women to carry out during that period. Again, that means we keep women engaged, they're more likely to return to work. So all these things are things that we're doing in policing to try and tackle some of the issues that arise from occupational segregation that lead to, obviously, gender pay gap as well.
Try and Rescue Service. Nicky mentioned the modernising agenda for police support staff. We've been fortunate enough to complete that process, and therefore we've managed to move over to integrated HR payroll systems from the legacy arrangements. And we're focused on bringing in our own pay and reward scheme so that we take out inequalities that we inherited from the legacy arrangements, and we've done that. We've still got more work to do, though, because within our support staff arrangements, particularly where there's the biggest gender pay gap, it is down to occupational segregation, and it's not a dissimilar pattern to the one that we heard described this morning. So women typically being in the lower paid jobs of cleaning, catering and administration, and our middle grade jobs, which typically are ICT and engineering, being occupied by men. I have to say that as we move into the more senior roles, there's much more of a balance. And at our most senior level below director, we have a 50-50 split on our senior management team within support staff. The board have also made a commitment to the 50-50 by 2020 agenda, and we now have a 40% female board after the latest round of board appointments. So we've completed our modernising agenda on pay for support staff, but there's more to do around occupational segregation as a key point. We're looking at the 50-50 by 2020 agenda for senior appointments, and we're making some good progress on that. Similar to other colleagues, we've looked at alignment with the Scottish public sector pay policy for low pay, and we are committed to the living wage, so all of our employees are on living wage as a minimum. And we're working through with the Poverty Alliance at this point in time our accreditation as a living wage employer. So we're trying to tackle that low pay issue. That's including extending the living wage and fair work into our procurement processes for the awarding of contracts within the parameters of EU procurement legislation, but we're following Scottish Government guidance to try and achieve that. We're also doing very much the developmental initiatives that colleagues have described. So we've reviewed our appraisal system. We're about to review our leadership management development programmes. We're looking at succession planning much more deeply. We're making sure that any gap between uniform staff, which are predominantly men, and support staff is objectively justified in terms of the role and the varying nature of the duties. And not so much around the gender pay gap itself, but you know, we are a predominantly male organisation. Firefighting is still traditionally seen as a male occupation, and we're working really hard to try and change that stereotype, but it is a long and painful journey. So our latest recruitment campaign focused on telling the stories, using social media, using the wider media to promote people who are not stereotypically seen as firefighters. And we were able to tell the stories of many female staff through those arrangements. And we did increase our attraction rate to 8%, but that is not enough. So whilst we had 8% attraction rates, we did actually take 14% into our recruitment round. So it's not so much that people are not able to be firefighters, they are able to achieve the fitness standards, etc., which typically they women would think were beyond them, but it is about improving our attraction rates and expanding those stories and trying to change the face of the fire service in terms of it being stereotypically male. But we've got quite a journey to go on that.
Wanted to come in with a supplementary.
Really, for Mr. Reid, I think you said that your pay was linked to length of service. Does that not mean it's automatically biased against women if they can never catch up?
Well, they will catch up provided they don't. If they have less time in their career, yes, they won't catch up. So incremental progression, which is the model that we have in the NHS, applies both to nurses, doctors and all of the Agenda for Change groups. So it's a kind of fundamental issue around progression based on length of service, that if you do take breaks, it's difficult to come in at the same level quite often. Now, you can do things to address that through a more proactive career break option, for example, but a lot of people, when they return from maternity leave, don't want any periods of unpaid leave, etc. So it is a difficulty in terms of the pay system. And what the talks at a UK level have begun to look at is lengthening the scales, cutting down and overlap, so that there would be, just now some of the scales have 7 or 8 points, there would only be 4 points on a scale. So some discussions have begun at the UK Staff Council to look at that both the trade unions and myself from a Scottish employer perspective are involved in, and that would help address the situation.
Thank you.
Could I just ask, on a follow-up to that, have you as organisations, NHS, Scottish Rescue and Fire Service, and indeed Police Scotland, looked at the issue of pension arrangements as part of looking at this topic of how pay arrangements affect this issue? Because, of course, there's been new pension regulations about part-time employees and so forth have been brought into force over the past few years. Have each of you looked at how these affect your employees?
To be honest, not specifically at this time. I think that's something we need to consider.
I think we're in the same position. I don't think we've looked specifically at what the impact of some of those changes are having. And so that's an area, yeah, we would need to, I think, begin to look at.
What I would say is, in policing, obviously, there was the changes to policing pensions fairly recently in our previous staff survey. That certainly came out as a number one concern for police officers, less so for police staff. Police staff currently are in the local government pension scheme, and police officers are obviously in a separate scheme. In terms of looking at specifically pensions, we have done some work recently. The Scottish Police Federation obviously raised concerns about the number of certainly younger officers opting out of the pension scheme. As a result of that, during our probationer training, we are more proactively focusing on raising awareness that it's important to save for your retirement. And in addition, although the police and pension scheme has changed, it's still one of the most competitive pension schemes you can be in, and raising awareness of the benefits of that. And again, we routinely do that at induction for police staff.
Move on to a question from Richard Leonard.
Thanks very much. My question was really just to look at the era that we're living in of one of very tight public finances, and in the case of local government, reducing public finances, I observe. I just wonder whether you could describe your understanding of any gender bias that comes with that public sector expenditure policy. I don't know whether Katy Miller can answer that.
I think what I would say is that whilst we've been going through transformation effectively for the last 15 months within City of Edinburgh Council, that is, every change that we embark upon goes through a very rigorous process of a business case. So that business case clearly starts with an end service user. It's designed within a cost envelope, which is an inevitability of it, but at each stage we have an equalities impact assessment, that's done. So that's both in terms of the outward service, but also any internal impact that we might have on equality. So we monitor that very consistently. We share that publicly. It's talked about regularly with the trade unions, who rightly keep us on our toes with that. So I think we're tight in terms of the organisational processes that we would go through. We obviously do a lot of impact assessment on pay as we look through that. We're very stringent on our job evaluation and keep us safe in that aspect. One of the areas that actually that was quite interesting last year is we too started to redesign our performance management framework. It was actually specifically not developed by HR, it was developed by our own workforce. So there was a working party, several hundred people, and they themselves have designed our whole approach to performance management, the language, everything around it. And one of the really interesting bits for me was that feedback was coming back to say that one-to-ones and appraisals were very task-orientated, so outcome-driven. On the one hand, that's great, but on the other hand, staff are saying, I'd love a conversation with my line manager where they actually get to know me as an individual. So they understand what my work-life balance looks like. They know where I've got carer issues, or they know when I might need to leave work on a particular time, but actually they've got trust in me that I'll still do the job I'm employed to do. So the core part of our new approach to performance management is about just great conversations. And one of the biggest aspects of those conversations is getting to know your team member and the work-life balance. So trying to bring that into the frame as well.
I would just reiterate some of that again in the NHS changes required to be equality impact assessed. And like the local authorities, we've got a strong organisational change policy that involves individual discussion with staff and responsibility to take on carer issues if there's going to be a change of location, for example, if their service is being reconfigured. So again, yeah, we do consider that. The issue in the NHS, as you'll be aware, is that very often transfer of services is difficult, but we do everything to make sure that people can be redeployed into their local area, if not in the same setting that they've come from.
Thank you. Don't feel obliged to all of you to answer every question. I should have actually said that at the outset rather than now. It's just obviously we have a limited time, but if you do want to come in on a specific issue, simply indicate that. Some questions clearly are more directed or able to be answered by some rather than others. I want to move on to questions from Jackie Bailey at this stage.
Okay, and this is directed at all of you except for Katy. I've got a slightly different question for Katy. I think it was Diane that raised 50-50 by 2020, and you seem to be quite confident that you will get there. I just wonder what the view is from the rest of the panel as to whether their boards will be compliant with that by 2020.
Again, my understanding is that they will be compliant through the public appointments process. In terms of executive appointments, then every panel we're now ensuring there's a gender balance on the panel and making sure that wherever possible we can appoint fairly and equitably, no matter what the background is of the individual.
Just to echo what Ian's saying, clearly the commitment's there from the police authority. What we'd say is it's a public appointment. Certainly I was speaking to our equalities officer the other day, and they were saying, you know, what work goes into where we advertise these appointments, you know, all these sort of things are actually fundamentally things that the Scottish Government have an influence over. So there's an element of we can certainly do our part in terms of gender balance in panels, all these sort of things. We can certainly raise awareness. We can put out adverts saying we're trying to attract particular groups or particular backgrounds. And it's working, I think, heavily with Scottish Government. I think the key is the duty to publish, obviously, and it goes back to the point Peter made earlier, kind of focuses minds. So that's an absolute critical aspect. So I think that's welcomed. And we are certainly committed to doing what we can in policing to ensure that that's achieved.
With our latest round of public appointments, when that's just worked through the system, we'll have a 60% female non-executive board, and our leadership team internally in the executive team is a 50-50 gender balance just now.
Good. Long may it continue. I'm curious about local government, though, because, you know, in the case of public boards, ministers appoint. Whatever you do about the pipeline, ultimately it's a matter for ministers. With elected politicians at local government level, it's a different picture. Is COSLA doing anything to encourage diversity, or is it something that you leave to political parties?
No, we would absolutely encourage it. So there's actually an equalities portfolio within COSLA, which I've just taken up about 6 weeks ago. So just actually one of the first meetings I had was with some of your colleagues here. So I met with a couple of your colleagues around actually, is there an opportunity for local authorities and yourselves to share an equalities plan, which I guess comes back to my point that many of us are trying to do the same thing. Mm. So actually build once and use many times. So certainly within COSLA, there's a whole raft of conversations that we'd be having around some of the best practice that's happening within local authorities. And whether that's kind of within a policy framework or actually culturally. So one of the, I guess, key things within Edinburgh that we've really focused on in the last year is the cultural aspect of leadership. So we have a whole raft of policies around flexible working, etc. And actually, for me, one of the most impactful things is around the role that leaders play. So the last 12 months has been a really sustained effort in what we'd call our wider leadership team, roughly the top 100 of our leaders, meeting every single month around their leadership, the impact they're going to make on the organisation. And we've now kind of cascaded that down, and we're into the next 600 managers. So we've got two-day workshops where we are just talking about great conversations, how to have them. So really driving the cultural bit from the top down as well as the, I guess, the policy bit from the bottom up. But yes, certainly COSLA have a very active role to play in this.
Okay, thank you very much. Shall I ask my next question, convener, or just wait?
Carry on.
Might as well do it now. And this is entirely for the Scottish Futures Trust. So can I ask, obviously, you know, SFT is responsible for coordinating billions of pounds of public investment in major infrastructure projects. I'm just wondering whether there's any consideration given to making it a requirement that, you know, the companies you deal with do something about the gender pay gap, whether it's reporting against it or actually taking measures to close it.
This is a particularly tricky area as what we're talking about interacts with European procurement rules, obviously. And there's two things that basically can be done in procurement, one of which is excluding parties from tendering for particular reasons. And the second is scoring characteristics or behaviours in the delivery of service to encourage people, as we said, with transparency, to adopt them. On the exclusion part of that, first of all, that's regulation 58.8, and I think that would be really tricky to apply in this area, either to the publication or to any steps taken to reduce the gender pay gap, because, well, first of all, as we all know, the requirement to publish in the private sector is only for large organisations. So I think it would be very difficult to impose that requirement on smaller organisations only for the purpose of public procurement. It might set up a bit of a two-tier within the SME community. And also, it might not be proportionate to exclude someone from procurement simply for failing to publish information on that basis. The sort of aspect around the nudge that comes from giving scores to particular behaviours, that is really driven through the Procurement Reform Act 2014 and the statutory guidance which is already in place there for the selection of tenderers around addressing fair work practices and using the living wage in particular. And that guidance is based around the fact that fair work practices will lead to the delivery of higher quality services. So that allows us to evaluate working practices as part of the service delivery that goes with tendering itself. And that guidance focuses on all aspects of fair work. It's got a focus on the living wage at present, but it includes in the sample invitation to tender question a question around steps that organisations and tenderers have taken to promote equality of opportunity in the development of a workforce which represents the population of Scotland. So that can, in a way, be scored, and there's no reason why any procuring authority shouldn't, if they wish, particularly refer to the gender pay gap in that question. I think there's a couple of caveats around that. First of all, in the field of major complex procurement, as you say, infrastructure, we need to be really careful about how much of a qualitative scoring in a tender process we can, if you like, afford to give to the employment practices of companies delivering the service, as opposed to how much you allocate to, for example, the quality of the end hospital or road that is being delivered through the procurement. And that's something that procurers wrestle with all the time, is how much of that percentage can they allocate to these areas. We also have pretty deep supply chains in these, in construction in particular, and it's quite difficult to, when these supply chains might not have come together at the stage of the procurement, to drive that analysis or any scoring down through supply chains. And as I said before, we need to be really careful that we don't inadvertently discriminate against SMEs that might have different practices, policies, and be perhaps less good, dare I say, at the essay writing part of tendering, and so that we really focus on the things that will drive change rather than the ability to answer a question well. Although, all of that said, if you do put these things in tenders, then it drives attention towards that area. And as we've heard before, the generality, in my view, is that attention on the subject and leadership attention is what will drive change overall. So it's a tricky area, but we can do things.
Just trying to unpick everything you're telling me, and what I heard was that actually you're not doing anything directly. Now that might be unfair, in which case do come back to me at that, but it just seemed to be in the too difficult to do box because of European procurement rules.
I think what we can do in procurement, as I said, is that area of scoring fair work practices as part of service delivery. Now, fair work practices has a whole host of different things sitting within it, and the one that has predominantly been focused on by procurers in that category to date has been payment of the living wage, as we all know. I think there is an opportunity to expand that further and to ask some more direct questions on gender pay gap. As I said, I think there is some risk if we do that simply through asking people or beginning to try and score people and the numbers associated with it. I would much rather we were able to score people on the steps they are taking to address it. And that is a very great challenge, but it's something that we're trying to do.
The case, will you now take this away as a specific piece of work and look at doing that in the billions of pounds of infrastructure projects that you coordinate?
Along with the Scottish Government's Procurement Directorate, yeah, we'll have a look at whether we can be more specific on those questions.
Excellent. Thank you.
And Gillian Martin.
Yeah, I think I have a specific question for Ian Reid about the NHS. There is a lot of evidence to say that you do have an issue with a lot of women not coming back after having children, particularly to GP roles. And I just want to ask specifically what you're doing as an organisation to address that, given that we do have GP shortages in the country, we do have shortages of practitioners, and a lot of them are women who find it too difficult to come back given the working practices that are expected of them in the NHS.
Yeah, the issue is complicated, as you know, because the NHS doesn't directly employ general practitioners, so there are issues about partnerships and the business arrangements around all of that. However, in any discussion we are now having with GPs where the partnership is struggling, for want of a better description, we are supporting in terms of part-time appointments that could be directly employed by the NHS, and the funding mechanism adjusted so that they are directly employed with the NHS but could still be part of a partnership locally, although would have not the same benefits that the other GPs obviously would have in that business sense. And again, through GP training, look at that, being more flexible so that people can work less hours during their training. It has issues, of course, about extending the training. However, the work of the Greenaway Commission was all related to that. It was about how could you be more flexible during the training period as well. And that's a significant issue, not only in general practice, but in hospital-based services, because of the hours and the training requirements currently that are there for junior doctors. But again, as you know, there's caps on what those working hours can be. And again, we're attempting to be as flexible as possible. I'm hesitant, I suppose, because I do think there's more to be done in that particular area. But I think it's a recognised issue that's having to be addressed. And I think you'll see more progress on that in the coming years.
And I think, I suppose I'd like to widen that out to other people in the panel as well, and particularly in the police and fire service, where a huge investment is made in people's training in order to get to that point. So staff retention is a really actually got a big cost issue for you. And how do you see addressing issues around the gender pay gap and flexible working as working in retention of staff?
Do you want me to go first? Staff turnover in Scottish Fire and Rescue Service is relatively small. I don't have the figure to hand, to be honest, but I could get it for you. We do have flexible working policies in place. We don't see necessarily a huge uptake on those within our uniformed staff who typically work 2 day shifts and 2 night shifts. We have done some staff surveys around that positive action work that I highlighted earlier, where staff have reported that those fixed work patterns are actually useful because they're set so far in advance it allows them to make childcare arrangements and provisions for caring responsibilities, etc. But we are moving into a new duty pattern this year, which is more of an annualised hours contract. So there will be a bit more flexibility in how people use their what we would call out of pattern rostered reserve, you know, in terms of being able to organise their work-life balance a little bit more flexibly. We have a range of opportunities out with the fixed shift pattern and what we would call day duty working patterns, which are typically Monday to Friday, but it is a much smaller cadre staff. And in terms of maternity and paternity provision, we did put a focus early on that as an organisation to get a harmonised position. And we do think we've got a fairly generous maternity and paternity provision scheme, and it's actually aligned with Police Scotland. We did a lot of benchmarking with colleagues to try and bring that into place. So we don't see turnover as a big issue. We do have policies to support people through flexible working, return to work after maternity, paternity or adoption provision. We have had some very nice stories that we used as part of our recent recruitment campaign around support for pregnant firefighters, and particularly one firefighter who needs support with IVF treatment, etc. You know, so we do have those arrangements in place to support staff where they're necessary, but they're typically not overly utilised given the demographics of our employee group, if that makes sense.
In terms of specifically, first of all, police officers, we have achieved obviously 30% females to males. That is obviously, as it's published just now, better than PSNI or England and Wales. So we feel we're on the right track in terms of trying to get gender balance in the first instance. Obviously, if we're to represent our communities, which is your ultimate aim, we've still got some way to go. But I think traditionally, policing has been viewed as a male-dominated industry. So to obviously get as far as we've come in the last few years is a positive, but it's to be built upon. So some of the things we're looking at to build upon that is, so we've got the Police Scotland Young Volunteers. We are finding that we're getting good gender balance within the volunteers. I don't have the figures with me. However, you know, that is very, very positive because, as some of the previous witnesses were talking about, making young women aware that policing is an option for them at a very young stage is absolutely critical. You know, it's getting into the mindsets of young people that, you know, there is nothing they can't do. If they want to pursue a particular career, there should be no barriers to doing that. So the Police Scotland Youth Volunteers, it's important that we are attracting both genders. In addition to that, we had a session in Aberdeen where we, again, were focusing on trying to encourage female applicants. From that, we've managed to appoint 4 out of 5 people that came to those sessions. So when people came, we allowed them to, for example, try out the fitness test, because sometimes psychologically women feel they won't be able to achieve it, and Diane's already commented on that. So being able to come along to a taster session and actually try out these things and say, well, actually, I can do that, I can apply for policing, is very positive. Then when obviously we actually attract people and start them with the organisation, I've already mentioned some of the work we've been undertaking in U Division in respect to maternity. We've also worked heavily with the Scottish Women's Development Forum, who, to be fair, as a partner, have been absolutely fabulous at working with us, identifying areas where the feedback is that women are concerned. This year alone, we've not only done work on maternity, the pay provision before last year, we obviously increased maternity provision for female officers. That was another, obviously, step in the right direction. So quite a lot going on in terms of the police officer side. In terms of the staff side, police staff are predominantly women. We certainly have a low turnover rate in terms of our police staff. And again, higher uptake of flexible working patterns. We actually have a good return to work rate, generally speaking. But we are constantly, I think, all of these issues, they're an element of you can never take your foot off the gas. You know, we've done a lot of work to get to 30%. And if we don't continue to focus on it, we'll slip back. I can tell you that absolutely. So we have to have that constant pressure, because the reality of it is that the Scottish Women's Development Forum played a video. It wasn't their video, but it was one that I think other people have seen. And it was about young children who were maybe, you know, 4 or 5, that kind of age. And they put a firefighter, a police officer, and an astronaut, and they all had helmets on. And every one of those children thought they were male. So the problem is if we stop as an industry pushing that, no, you can't have these careers, there's so many social biases that, you know, we're fighting against that we will lose the traction. So there's constant work for us all to do with education providers, with, you know, early childcare, all of these, we've all got a responsibility to be sending out a consistent message that there's not a career that's kind of specific to one gender or not that people can't have a think about and potentially have a go at.
Returning to work is one thing and making it easy for women to return to work, but what about progression? Up the grades, should they opt to have the flexible hours, the agile working?
So in terms of promoting progression, our most recent stats show that we are getting a good balance up our ranks. There is 2 blips, and that's at our superintendent and our exec level just now, so we know we've got work to do there. But the broad picture, since we've started reporting, has been that we are actually, you know, increasing female promotion. We haven't got stats done specifically around those that are maybe in flexible work patterns and how that's affecting their promotion. Obviously, trying to produce data and do comparisons, were restricted by our systems and how flexible or otherwise they are. But certainly in the stats that we are able to pull just now and are looking at, we are seeing that we've got a good picture and a positive picture of where female promotion is going. We do have work to do, and it's reflected in the mainstreaming report around temporary promotions, because what we're finding is we're having quite a good rate in substantive promotions, but we have to look at temporary promotions and how we make sure that we are fair and equitable on that as well, and we are doing work internally on that at the moment.
Thanks. You want to come back in?
Yeah, maybe I should have mentioned during my response was the challenge of our services in general practice as well, which I'm sure members will be aware of, and the work that Sir Lewis Ritchie has been doing about developing community hubs, etc. And some service redesign issues will be critical, I think, in sustaining some of the services given the way that the workforce is changing in terms of its expectations of working patterns.
Have you got any comment on the last point that I asked about in terms of progression, when you've maybe had a career break for caring of any type and you come back, whether or not that's going to put any of your progression in jeopardy at all, and how do you monitor that?
My own sense is that we've got sufficient flexibility in terms of working hours, etc., particularly nursing, for example, so that there are opportunities for people to take on more senior roles on a part-time basis.
Maybe in the areas where you haven't got that.
I would say it's still a challenge, both in medicine and some of the healthcare sciences, for example.
And what's specifically been done to address it?
Again, just looking at ways that we can provide services perhaps more flexibly by substitution of certain grades, etc., so that some of the work that can be done in less time, potentially. So issues like that, but I would say that we're still a bit a way off getting a real solution to it.
Okay. Thank you. I think Dean Lockhart had a question on the economic relationship of this matter.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard from the panel today a number of measures taken across your organisations to address gender pay and related issues. I just would like to get a sense of what economic or other steps have the most impact in addressing this issue, because we've heard a lot of encouraging measures and encouraging steps, all of which are heading in the right direction, but to help us as a committee to understand in practice what has the most impact, it'd be good to get a sense from each, briefly, from each of the guests as to what has the most impact. It will be interesting to see if it's the same answer or different measures have different impacts across different organisations. Katy Miller mentioned a change of leadership or a change of culture and focus of leadership on this issue as being very, very impactful. Would there, perhaps I can start with you, would there be other measures you would put up there in terms of having very, very direct impact? Mm.
So I probably think at a societal level, one of the pieces that came through from the COSLA feedback, so from the local authorities that did respond, because I'm actually here on behalf of them, would be around the extension of childcare infrastructure and provision, which I'm sure is something you've probably heard previously. But that would be a very common theme that's come through. And perhaps the sense that until we can reach a position whereby, either through stereotypes or actually through provision, women aren't taking on the majority of the carer's role, that actually until we're in a position of being able to do that, the take-up of the kind of equality of role perhaps is lacking.
I agree that at the sort of society level, the transparency point we've all talked about, and occupational segregation, steps to address that, and family-friendly policies in the workplace. But inside organisations, I think a lot of it is about leadership examples, and really, particularly, I speak for a smaller organisation, as I've said, the flexibility for every single worker in every single situation, and really thinking through that for the individual and for the organisation, and keeping the focus on that at the level of individuals, is what seems to make a difference for us, rather than having a very rigid, this is what happens in this situation. It's about, well, how can we make what works for you work for us in this situation, and to keep great people in great jobs.
Have said, I think for us as an organisation, and I'm sorry for repeating it, but we are a fairly new organisation with a long history. So our focus has been on making sure that our pay and reward frameworks are transparent and are free from bias as much as they can be, and making sure that we've followed that modernising pay agenda in line with Scottish public sector pay policy and living wage accreditation. Living wage accreditation has been a real focus for us and has been very important. I think more work around attraction into what are stereotypically male roles is something that we can all try and work harder on at societal level, as colleagues have mentioned. That comes from the leadership examples, the stories, how the these roles are portrayed in the media, how they're supported at a political level, etc. So that's a wider societal change piece. And I think in terms of impact, to maybe answer the question specifically, I think the living wage accreditation and how that's impacted in the supplier chain, while it won't address the overall gender pay gap, it certainly starts to send a message out about pay transparency and transparency in the public sector, generally speaking. For the service, as I've mentioned before, our challenge is attracting women into our uniformed roles. I think we'll start to see a change as our service starts to redesign and change and respond to a demand for our services and our traditional demand for services and what communities are going to demand of our services in the future. And that will start to change the shape of the role of a firefighter, which will help the stereotyping issue. And in terms of that leadership progression, we have put in place the usual forums, networks, support groups, linking in with other partner agencies that colleagues have already mentioned. And I don't think we can put our finger on that any one of those makes the most impact. It's a collection of all, and depending on what your data is telling you and depending on what circumstances your organisation is facing at a particular point in time, will depend on which one of those is going to lend most weight. But we need to have all of those things in our tool bag, I think.
I don't think my thought relates to the gender pay gap necessarily, but as you'll be aware, most of the professions in the NHS now are degree based, and a lot of NHS boards are looking to see how they can bring in particularly young people into the caring professions that might not have the educational qualification at the outset, but can support them either through skills development or modern apprenticeships, so they can begin to make a transition onto a profession, if that's the way that they choose to go. But how we attract young people in particular into the caring professions, I think, will be a challenge going forward as well.
I think... Oh, apologies.
Okay, please.
Peter's already mentioned the importance of role models. We've got a very proactive DCC in Rose Fitzpatrick, who not only is a role model herself, but she's very proactive in that she works well with the Scottish Women's Development Forum. She speaks to our women. She comes back to the ranch and says, what are we doing about? She's constantly challenging. She takes active participation in the promotion processes. She will go out and engage and write, in fact, to individuals to say, why aren't you applying for this? Because she knows from her reading and industry statistics that women will tend to avoid going for promotion as early as their male counterparts. So we are very lucky in that we've got role models, but in addition to that, we've got the public sector pay policy, where I've already commented that in terms of the Scottish Living Wage, we've pushed that provision through work at a local level. I think there's a lot more work we do and we require to do more of around engaging fathers and promoting flexible working across the service. One of the previous witnesses to this committee spoke about the fact that parental leave and shared maternity leave is not getting taken up in general by obviously fathers. There is an element of a lot of that relates to pay provision. Now, your question specifically related to kind of the economic factors. The difficulty is if you start obviously putting occupational pay up, that has a cost to it. However, if we don't start to do things like that in the public sector, then clearly we will not encourage more males to partake in that. But there is a cost, and with kind of compressed public sector budgets just now, that's a challenge for all of us. So there is things that ideally we could be looking at, or we should be looking at, but economics do play a part in what we can actually achieve.
Thank you.
Thank you. John Mason, did you have a short question?
Short question. Well, it was really, I think it was following on from Jackie Bailey's first question, which was on boards, like targets and quotas for boards. And I was really thinking about further down and the organisation. I mean, do you think, not just for your own organisation, but generally, it is advantageous to have targets and quotas and so on? Because I think, for example, the police, I think you've been successful maybe at the top and at the bottom, but I think we've heard previously that in the middle there can be a bit of resistance.
Well, as it stands just now in our current mainstreaming report, we're broadly achieving quite well across our ranks, with the exception of superintendent. We've had a dip this year, and our executive. So we're not complacent. We know that there's work to be done. I've already mentioned that our DCC, Rose Fitzpatrick, does do an incredible amount of work. It is an area that, because of the small numbers, especially in the executive, one or two leavers can make a huge difference statistically. And that goes to the point Peter was making earlier as well. So there's a lot of work to be done. Equally, when you look at areas in the exec, and that policing as a service, you come in, you join as a constable, then you go to a sergeant, and you have to work your way up the ranks. There's no chief constable that hasn't been a constable. So the difficulty is certainly within our exec, you're talking about people who are broadly at about 25 plus years service. So you're looking at the recruitment practices of 25 years ago, and it goes back to that age and length of service and the difficulties you've got in trying to balance that. So the work we are doing now to encourage and increase the number of applicants and people joining the service as women are obviously going to impact the service in 30 years' time, hopefully when I'm retired. So
I think you said 30% is what you've got at the moment, is that
30%,
right?
30%, that's
correct. Are you aiming
for 50? Well, we're always aiming to improve it. We don't have a specific target over and above the kind of outcome of trying to reflect our communities and be more reflective of those communities, and obviously the communities in Scotland have slightly more than 30% female, but that is, it's constantly working on having role models. If you look at our material, even from a few years ago to now, our marketing and everything else, we can actually now go to virtually every area. You can go up to the islands and still find a female officer, and make sure that when you're doing marketing in any area, you've got a gender balance for a recruitment stall. While if you'd went back even 5 years ago, you might have struggled in some areas to do that. So I think as you progress and as you increase the number of women, it's got a kind of return on investment, if you like. But there's always work to be done, because, as I say, you are still living with that historic recruitment practice, and you've got to constantly be doing work to ensure that you don't slip back.
Okay, I accept that. I mean, fire, you said 8%, I think. Is that your recruitment, 8% of your recruits are women?
Our last recruitment campaign, we had an 8% attraction rate, and we recruited 14% of the intake was female.
Right.
Overall, it's roughly 92% to 8% at this point in time.
So how long would it take you to get to 50%, or would you not want that?
I don't think I could reasonably comment on that, if I'm being perfectly honest. And I think generally speaking, and this is maybe more of a personal view rather than a view of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, I think targets are helpful in some ways, because they, as we discussed earlier, they focus the mind, and you have action plans, etc. But clearly, targets can also have negative connotations. And feedback we get from women is, well, I only got promoted because I was a woman, or you only took me in because I was a woman. So you've got to be careful with target setting and the perceptions that sets within the wider population, either in terms of your candidate pool, if you're bringing people in, or in terms of your internal promotion arrangements. So targets is not something that we are specifically looking at. I think, like Nicky, we are constantly trying to find ways to improve our attraction rates, and when we can achieve that, then I think we'll actually start to see the progression of women through our fire service careers. But we do have a journey to go on, and there's no point in saying otherwise. As I mentioned earlier, though, we are moving into an arena over the next few years where the types of services that we might provide are starting to change. So we're looking at responding to things like out-of-hospital cardiac arrests, a wider emergency medical response service, much more support for vulnerable groups in our communities. And that might attract a different kind of person to join our organisation, and we need to capitalise on that in terms of our brand moving forward. So not setting targets, but aware that we've got more to do.
Point on that, and I put on my engineering hat as a civil engineer rather than maybe as my SFT hat, but the we talked about some of the input things that are going to make a difference in all of this, and there could be a place for targets and publication in there. For example, we heard before about partnering with schools, and we know a lot of construction companies and people in our supply chains are looking to how many visits to the site have you had, how many school visits have you made, how many people have you contacted in sort of showing what this profession and this area and sector can mean to you. So I think right at the other end from the targets and quotas about what we get out of all of this, but the targets of what we're measuring about how much we're trying to change perceptions right from an early age in professions and sort of set up the ability to measure the difference people are making at that right early stage would be a step in the right direction as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Perhaps two final questions for myself. First of all, the gender pay gap is the numbers used, you know, the 4% or the 13% gender pay gap is effectively a calculation, so a number. And not that to discount that as a measure to look at these issues, but I think certainly Police Scotland and COSLA in the written submissions talked about other aspects, flexible working, flexibility of contracts, that sort of thing. Is it the case we should be looking at more than just the numbers in terms of the monetary payment when we look at this issue to address where we're at and where we should be going? I'd just be interested in each of your views on that.
In the last mainstreaming report, we did actually put data in there in regards to flexible working requests. And actually, we actually also commented on the fact that from our last mainstreaming report, we had fewer applicants. It's a very complicated area because when you start to monitor and look at the reasons, it's really about getting behind the data. So we have tried to do sort of exit surveys and other things to try and understand what the data is trying to tell us, because it's one thing having the statistics, but if you don't understand why they're coming out the way they are, it's really unhelpful. So I think there's an element of statistics help, but you've actually got to do proactive work with other partners as well. So the Scottish Women Development Forum, I've mentioned, they work very proactively with us. They're able to do surveys and engage with women and other groups for that matter to give us that kind of feedback as a service to say, what about? That's led to us having engagement with other partners as well in respect to the Commission for Human Rights and Equalities. We've just done maternity work with them as well as a result of that relationship. So I think we do need to do more. We need to get behind, but we need to look at the value. And one of the previous witnesses commented on, it's been published that 5%, you know, you have to increase your wage by 5% to move if you're giving up your flexible working pattern. I can totally understand that, because if you've got a flexible working pattern, it can reduce your childcare costs, all these other things. So I think trying to understand better how people put values on things and is really important for us. But equally, there's other aspects to it, and it's so for example, with our police officers, if somebody wants to increase their hours after decreasing their hours, they can do that as a police officer automatically. They can increase their hours. And it means that you don't have that underutilisation as people, you know, as the kids start going to school and all these other things that give people more time and they'll start to increase their hours. We don't have those provisions, for example, for police staff, where, you know, people could start looking at saying increasing their hours. Now, arguably, it can be more difficult because you might have smaller groups and more specialists, so just increasing hours can become inefficient. But I think there's various things that we have to look at and start saying, well, what's in the art of the possible to try and see where we can encourage women and give women opportunities to do things like, because it's definitely successful on the police officer side. So there's an element of learning from different pay systems and provisions to try and assist us in our learning across the board, but a lot more work to be done on it.
Briefly from others.
I think the direct answer to your question is yes. I think a total reward package would be useful to highlight. The challenge there is how do you place value on certain elements of that total reward package so that you can do that benchmarking comparison. So the average hourly rate of basic pay is a very simple comparison that you can make with other organisations. We are looking at that wider total reward package and benefits scheme because people do place value on flexible working as opposed to perhaps an hourly rate in some cases. But I'm not quite sure that we'd have the answer as to how you tot all those elements of the reward package up to give you some kind of gender pay gap analysis. But certainly, in terms of the transparency in the reward packages, if you're promoting that, it allows people to make choices, both men and women, if you've got that flexible reward package. That's certainly our aspiration, but we're not quite there yet.
And I was just going to make a similar point because it related to the earlier point about the pay structure, because clearly what the statistics do demonstrate is there may be significant problems with the pay structure. That takes time to change, but the pay structure needs to begin to include some of the things that you've been talking about. So while the hourly rate is important, those wider issues need to come into that context as well.
There's maybe some other bits that we haven't addressed on what allows flexibility as well, and some of the enablers of that that we need to look at in organisations. And we're involved in smarter workplaces across the public sector, and the idea of if we have multi-site operations or indeed the public sector ability to collaborate so you can work in a different location and access your IT system and your pass gets you into the building, and all of these sort of infrastructure and hard end of the organisation aspects that can help promote a more flexible way of working overall, that I think can help, as well as some of the leadership aspects and developments and policies and practices that we've been talking about as well. So it's not to forget the sort of harder end of business infrastructure that can support those flexible practices.
I was just going to say, in terms of the total reward piece or total value statements, I think one of the most insightful things is when you do give employees the opportunity to almost kind of pick and mix, and actually that gives you a huge amount of insight around where they put their value, and that's both in terms of monetary, but as equally as important, the non-monetary aspects as well.
Okay, and finally, Ian Reid touched on this. I think you mentioned that I think the majority of female of students coming through from university now in medicine are female, and I think you also said the NHS degree it requires degree-based qualifications for employment. Now, I'm just wondering, we've all heard of firefighting, and of course you're public-based bodies with limited budgets. And I did ask the question about, you know, have you looked at the issue of pensions, for example, and how the changes affect employees and the differentials there. But I understand, and I'm sure everyone does, the sort of restraints you have to work within, the constraints of budget, of time, and this sort of thing. Now, if we take, for example, the issue of university students, where there's now a recognised problem, which is that it's the majority are female rather than male, and the Scottish Funding Council has asked the universities to address that, to reduce the gap in that. But things like that come through and obviously affect your organisations in terms of employment forward planning. How realistic is it to expect you to address these issues? Is it a matter of trying to create a level playing field now, equality of opportunity through various ways that we've talked about, and try to move the ball forward? Is it realistic that you can achieve that? Or, I mean, one can have good intentions, but it's the practical level is much more difficult. I think everyone understands
I think the point you raise is well made, because I don't think necessarily we can change it within our own organisations alone. In the example of education, we did some work when I was in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde with the colleges and the Scottish Funding Council to address the issue I was describing. Well, that was done on a partnership basis, because they had to bring funds to the table as well as the NHS. So I think a lot of the solutions across public sector, and I think we just need to think about how we can work more effectively together in tackling some of these issues.
Final comment from one of the others, if they wish, or Diane Vincent.
Just
agree with what Ian said, and in terms of your question about whether it's realistic, I don't think it's something that can be achieved in the short term, but if we don't keep tackling the issues in the way that we've discussed both in this session and in the earlier session, then we are not going to make progress. And we are making progress, maybe not at the speed that all of us would like to see, but I do genuinely believe progress is being made. And as I mentioned earlier, all the things that we've discussed are tools that you have to have in your tool bag, and you need to deploy them appropriately within your own organisation. I've certainly found this session very useful. I've enjoyed listening to other people's experience. I've taken a few takeaways. So, we will endeavour to continue on this journey, and I think we have to. It's the right and proper thing to do, and it's also organisationally the sensible thing to do as we start to look at demand for services and how we best serve our communities. So that would be my final comment.
Well, thank you very much. We will take that as the final comment, and thank you to all of our witnesses for coming today, and I'll close this session, and perhaps that will allow for people from Public Gallery to leave the room. We'll move into private session. Thank you very much. Thank you.